seconds.
Oh, see, I'm exactly. I do seconds. The whole thing with the machine telling me you have 2 miles to go. Pick up the pace, and then Lance Armstrong comes on and says, "Don't do drugs. Run faster. You've broken a record." Hey, welcome to Oktobercast, guys. This is we're in the 11th hour, starting the 11th hour right now. How are you feeling, Gary?
Tired.
Norm?
Also tired.
I also am tired.
It's a good thing that we have great guests.
Yeah.
Both now and to come, and some exciting activities to keep us
fantastic
energized activities. And awake.
I'm because saving this is definitely all my energy.
The back half of this is always the tough one.
So coming in the hero hour once again, Patrick Norton, you carried us
getting
through
us
last
through
year.
The wee small hours, just like you did last year.
And Drew Scanlon, who was originally scheduled for like 1 a.m. but got stuck on you were driving.
I was coming back from Sacramento.
I can't believe you wouldn't cancel whatever business you had in Sacramento for something as you know.
It was pretty important business.
Okay. Did you get married?
No.
I think we were having some audio problems on your end. Maybe.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you were making some shorting out noises there or something. I think that was...
Sorry.
How's this? Oh. You sound much better now.
All right, great.
What were you doing in Sacramento?
Can
you talk about it? Well, I don't want to put
I
you
know,
on
I can.
Spot.
Yeah. Okay. Do you want the long version
give
or
the short version?
Let's take
we'll
the
ask
long
questions.
Version.
Well, we got to do station hour. ID and stuff right, here in a minute.
Yeah, but, yes, let's remind people why we do this.
Quick station ID.
This is happening for Child's Play. So we do a 24-hour podcast every year because people like to pay money to watch us suffer, it turns out. And if you would like to pay money to watch us suffer more, you can go to tested.com/donate. All the information is there. The money we don't touch any of the money. So even though Gary's had an amazing idea and said we should just take the giant sum of money that we're collecting and go to Vegas and put it all on black because you can't lose.
Or red. Or if you really want to have some balls, no. Double zero.
No.
The odds on that are real bad. But black or red.
No, the odds are great.
Chance.
You get 35 times your bet.
Patrick, remember to go get his phone. That's a good idea. I can't believe all this time you've had that in the back of your head. Don't forget my phone, which I threw across the room earlier on in the evening.
It's a parenting skill. Pick it up.
That's good.
Is the phone
that's
okay?
Good.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Tested.com/donate. We are, if you're watching on YouTube, you can join us in the live chat on Tested. Tested.com/live. You'll have to create an account. It takes like 5 minutes. We're not going to spam you or do anything horrible with your personal information. And you can talk in the chat with the 700 other people, 609 other people.
I feel like we are in the grand undulating waveform scheme of this thing? Because this thing does have a life of its own.
Yeah.
And I remember, especially having done it last year, that I feel like there is a predictable pattern that emerges. Yes. And you go from... I know exactly where we are now in this.
Okay.
You can see
it
clearly.
It goes from the first few hours, excitement, enthusiasm, positivity, all things are possible. Money starts rolling in. Looking forward to what's ahead. That starts to roll into fatigue, depression...
Yeah.
Self-pity.
Yeah.
All those things. That's kind of where we are right now. But where I feel like we're coming out of and the area that I feel like we're moving into, and again, I remember this from last year, is a weird kind of second wind that emerges out of that exhaustion. And you have like this fake burst of... Do you remember that? Like
we're coming out of the trough already?
You start to get really punchy.
The second wind.
I don't think we're there yet. I'm saying I feel like that's the next phase.
I had second wind at like 8 o'clock last year.
That's the next stage.
Second wind happens the final... three or four hours
because I was in tears by the end of the 24 hours last year.
Yeah, so you have, but I think you have that
real
second wind, but then you realize that it's a castle built on sand.
Oh,
and then you just plummet even deeper into the abyss.
That's the final
of exhaustion.
Yeah,
and but by then you can see the finish line, and that. Keeping your eye on the prize is enough to just get you over that final
stage. It turns out in that final like 2 hours, you can zone out for maybe 20, 30 minutes and nobody will notice you're not talking anymore.
I certainly didn't.
You can just kind of like be like, and you look up and you're like, wow, how did it get to be 5:15 already? That's crazy.
That's great.
We're almost there.
When the hands on the clock start whizzing round, that's a good sign.
The pumpkin is
that's
on fire.
You want. Time lapse.
The pumpkin's on fire.
Time lapse mode.
don't worry about it.
It's cool.
We want to talk about auctions that we're doing?
Yeah, so right now, I made something. It's right up here. I don't think I can reach it. Maybe Norm can. That is a 3D printed heart, gear heart. It was designed by Emmett on Thingiverse. It's a variant of a variant of a variant, but it's an open SCAD program that you run on a 3D model to make an interlocking mesh of gears.
Oh yeah, how's the bidding going on that?
I haven't looked in a while, Norm.
Whoa, we should check it out.
Oh wow,
isn't that cool?
I think it's at $220 is the high bid right now. So, what did we said we're going to go to 6 a.m. So there's two more hours.
So by the way, so you know, $500 of the $1,500 that we raffled for the pistol.
Okay,
$500 is in. The other 1,000 apparently is coming subsequently.
Okay.
It may not be here by the end of the 24 hours, but we can certainly, theoretically add it.
There's a charity on layaway.
Knowing that our winner is good for it.
We have, I know the user in question. $500 is more than enough to hold the item in question.
Yeah, that's a pretty good deposit.
So this heart is actually pretty amazing, not only in its function, but also in that it's Finnish.
Yeah, so it's
I feel like I'm on QVC right now.
I was so trying not to make that comment.
No, it's fine. It's what we're doing.
Norm's a natural for this sort of thing.
Yeah. Last year,
I could also slam samurai swords on tables and break them.
Yeah.
And then sell Dell PCs right afterwards.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I'll take the blade to the knee, and then we can all go to the hospital together. So it's a PLA printed pieces. I think it prints in about 8 pieces, and I put it on our replicator. But you can print on any 3D printer. It doesn't matter. It's just on the other side of the curtain. I was pointing over there, but. It's PLA, so it's polylactic acid, which I just started printing with a few weeks ago. It's what they use for the new replicator too. It's what they recommend, and it turns out it's a lot easier to work with than ABS because ABS cools very slowly, and you end up with this warping effect when you print things with large bases. The PLA cools much faster, so the shrinkage happens very quickly, and there's no warping effect. It makes it much easier to print huge things. And while that giant ABS print of the same heart was probably a pretty intense print on a thingamatic or an early replicator, this was really a piece of cake and came out more or less on the first try. So I then took it home and put spray filler, basically Bondo, on it, spray primer filler, to fill in the holes on the ridges on the 3D printing, you know, from the individual layers. Sanded that down pretty well. And then put some 3D some red enamel on it. I've said before, and it's up to the person whoever ends up having the high bid. I'm more than happy to do it again. I hadn't spray painted it. I hadn't painted anything with the aerosol paint in about 20 years. So I'd forgotten all of the tricks about the rate at which you should apply paint to the surface. And there were some pretty gnarly drips, so I had to sand that stuff down. And it looks okay, but it's not great, and it's cracks in the surface because it dried unevenly and all that. So I would be happy to make another one. We'll send detailed pictures to the winner, and they can decide if they want this one with charming flaws or if they'd like one that is closer to perfect or an improved edition.
Hey, Patrick, you want to do a Mad Libs?
You know, we are due for 2 Mad Libs because
we are overdue.
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
How can I say no?
So, again, tested.com/donate if you want to donate to Child's Play. And if you want to bid on the heart, we should tell this before we go on. Send an email to tips@tested.com with the subject line Gear Heart and your bid. As of right now at 4:10 a.m., the high bid is $220. So that's all right. That's where we're at right now.
This is Gary, from Mad Lib.
Aren't you going to let him choose? He has Star Wars.
Well, I'm going to give you. Okay, I'll give you the choice. We have Mad Libs from Outer Space. We have Monster Mad Libs, and we even have Star Wars Mad Libs. So you can take your pick from these three.
I'm going to warn you: the Star Wars Mad Libs have Mad Libs from all 6 movies. So we will be selecting.
Well,
I
will not.
Trilogy.
Don't worry. I will not pick one from the shitty movies. Don't worry. You'll be guaranteed original trilogy if you do decide to go with Star Wars.
Yeah, I was going to say, Jar Jar Binks, bad. I'll take the basic space one.
You know, we never found out what Drew was doing in Sacramento.
Mad Libs from Outer Space. Well, why don't you ask about that while I figure this out?
He's a spy. He's just been to North Korea. Right. I think you're really going to find out
your
what
he's activation word is Toledo, Sacramento.
Do you want to do all this right. first or is that first?
We generally, not to, you know, of Let's course, you pick
do
whatever
this
you want.
And then we'll come
we
down.
Do we find time. That we tend to have more fun when you know, allow your...
Be the, clever or
the
filthy,
most scatological
one or the
parts
other.
Of your imagination to run riot.
Let my potty mouth loose.
Absolutely.
Yeah, let your freak flag fly,
all right.
fly, man.
So let's start with an adjective.
Fucked.
I think Patrick is gonna be on the money start. Here. A noun.
Shit. Let's just go right down to
wow,
the
bottom. Wow, you're getting hold on, there's a fine line.
Are you saying shit?
Why not? It is a noun.
I'm fucking loving it.
Oh, that was just
a plural noun.
I never get to curse on air, so it's very exciting.
I know, isn't it great?
It's going to be on YouTube tomorrow. You with it.
And plural noun.
Plural noun. sorry, I can't say that out loud. aardvarks.
Oh. Wow, they are filthy animals.
The shits.
Where's aardvark? Is aardvark an African animal?
Texan.
Nationality.
No, that's armadillos.
Oh, you're absolutely right.
Yeah. Let's get topical with this. Nationality.
That's really funny. I'm so not going there right now. Sorry, I was a nationality of aardvarks. Man, let's just keep it home and go American.
You could have said North Korean.
I could have.
But he made the right
he
choice.
He may be going back, and I don't want to get in trouble. Yeah, yeah.
Something round.
Ball.
And a number.
7.
The last name of a person.
Smith.
I don't like where this is going.
Adjective.
Can we repeat adjectives or should we go?
You can do whatever you want.
Go right back to fucked again.
I like that. That's a go-to adjective right there.
This is like an episode of Inside the Actor's Studio.
A person in the room.
We'll take it out on me this time. Patrick.
All right.
Okay. Tempting as it is to torture Will again.
No, go for it. I mean, at this point, I won't feel anything.
A type of food.
Gelato.
Why not?
Two girls
and
gelato.
A noun.
Freak.
Freak?
Mm-hmm.
Occupation.
Journalist.
Adjective.
Let's go right back to fucked again.
I think this is going to pay dividends, by the way.
Wow. You know, it's only been done 3 times in Mad Lib World Series.
Sorry, it's just, you think with an English degree, adverbs would just pop up in my head immediately. Just
take a normal adjective and smack L-Y on the end and you're good.
Robustly.
What's that?
Robustly.
I guess a noun. Well, no, it's an adjective.
How is robustly a noun?
No, I was thinking about robust, but I was like, no, that's
robust
not.
Robust isn't a noun either.
I understand my mistake. That's why I backed away from it immediately.
Fucking hell. Verb ending in ing.
I can't get some slack
fucking.
For it.
Patrick is going to be a fucking star here.
You're the strong.
It's not easy to. It's not difficult to make good Mad Libs. You just do rude words, and it's gold every time.
The secret of being
12. And finally, a verb. Let's end strong.
Sneezed.
Sneeze
or fucking, whichever you prefer.
I think sneeze is probably going to be real filthy here.
So this. Mad Libs from Outer Space.
Of all the traditions we could have had, I don't know how Mad Libs ended up being the tradition.
Great.
Because it was great last year.
Oh. Yeah. Plus, singing bingo in a live podcast drives everyone insane. But they're both used to pass times and long car journeys.
We could do Sudoku or something.
We could do the license plate game. How many license plates have you seen from Texas since we've been in the car? Wait. None.
Okay, so this Mad Lib, as it turned out, was about Copernicus.
I thought we were doing the Star Wars Mad Libs.
No, this is Outer Space.
Oh, okay. So it's
we'll
about
do Star Wars.
Okay,
next.
Okay.
400 years ago, people knew little about our fucked universe. They thought that the Earth was the center of the entire shit, and that the Sun and all of the aardvarks revolved around it. But then an American named Copernicus discovered the truth: the Earth revolves around the ball 7 times a year. Copernicus, whose last name was
true.
Smith. Was born in Warsaw, and he used one of the first fucked telescopes, which was invented by Patrick Norton. This primitive telescope was little more than 2 pieces of gelato stuck on each end of a freak. In 1600, an Italian journalist named Galileo expanded Copernicus's fucked theories, but during the Inquisition in Italy, he was robustly arrested. After fucking for 6 months in jail, Galileo was forced to sneeze. See, I think that one kind of works.
You know what it is? You just wrote a textbook in the world of Idiocracy.
Pretty much.
That's it. Right, it was just 2 pieces of gelato stuck together with some sticks, a telescope.
I think that one kind of works.
Copernicus, good old Copernicus Smith. from Warsaw.
As long as it's rude, actually true, it doesn't matter if it's nonsensical.
Well, I'm telling you.
We can try a Star Wars one. I think we should do one at a time. I think when we come to you, you can do Star Wars.
If I am so lucky.
And we'll see how you
Drew will still have to do one. Yeah. But we want to hear your story first about what you were doing earlier this evening.
All right, so
the long one.
Norm's killing time at this point.
The long
this
version?
Had better be long good version. If it's going to be long.
As long as it's a good story.
Yeah, if it's not a good story.
Wait, is a story?
I don't know how good it's...
Why don't you tell us the short version? We'll ask you to expound and
were you buying
details.
Something off Craigslist?
No.
Were you trying to get laid?
No. Well, no.
It could be one and the same thing.
Was there a
house
wedding?
House shopping?
No.
Funeral?
Nope. All right, so...
Drugged by?
Astute viewers of Giant Bomb and... I guess tested to some degree.
Hi.
May recognize. Let me back up.
Did you go and buy a bunch of TurboGrafx shit in Sacramento?
No. What do I look like, Jeff Grisman?
I mean, I figured you might have been like, hey, Drew, I've got something to do this weekend. Can you do me a favor?
Oh, sorry.
Okay, that's good. I'm glad you didn't do that.
All right, so we use this piece of equipment called the TriCaster. Joe's using one right now.
Yeah, it's awesome. It puts fire on the screen.
Yeah, it's cool like that.
I hope to beta test the original series of TriCasters.
Did you really? You're going to like the story then.
I bet I'm swapping a TriCaster now.
Swapping a TriCaster in an obscure place.
I predicted the story.
Okay, so...
Did you predict it outside of your head where it can be verified that you predicted it?
Yes, something related to a video tying to the TriCaster.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
All right, so...
The chat thinks that you Sherlock married the TriCaster.
No.
Sherlock Holmes this shit.
So the TriCaster is what all our cameras feed into. Allows us to switch between them. And it also will overlay video files.
So like Fire and...
Like Fire and...
It's a television studio.
Yes. And yeah, very on if I was seeing a live so demonstration right now.
Right, this is the TriCaster lady. We met her at NAB.
Her name is Kiki.
Is it like a tutorial lady or something?
So yes. When you buy a TriCaster...
Okay. When you buy a TriCaster, all this random video stuff comes with it, including that shot of Kiki on the green screen there.
Right.
It's a tutorial. Kiki wife
it's to show you how to use the green screen.
Right, sure. It's just test
it's
footage.
It's also a sample video.
To allow you to test the key. And,
so you can take that and project your own stuff onto the green screen.
Like
Kiki
on fire,
could be
guys.
Here. Right.
Oh, sure,
she goes.
This is a fancy
you
video.
You can't just
effects.
Throw stuff out there like that, Will.
Okay,
it's got to cook. Yeah.
Okay. I just want to see something burn.
So, Kiki shows up in a lot of our stuff. Usually Thursday night throwdowns. It's just popping in to say hi, or maybe sometimes really small on a table, stuff like that, on fire.
Yeah.
And the only way that we know, yeah,
she's replaced Patrick.
She's here with us right now. The only way we know her name is Kiki is that the file name is, Kiki on green screen. And someone posted in our forums, like, who is this lady that keeps showing up on Giant Bomb's live streams?
She's a legend. I first met her like 15 years ago.
And the truth is, she's really just like the picture that comes with the frame, right? It's just this generic person.
So.
She's done more demos of more video equipment at more shows than probably any other human being.
Oh, like that's what she does. Yeah. That's her skill.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I took it upon myself to find out who Kiki was. She originally.
Q Star Trek band.
Yeah. She originally was.
Is she an actress?
She burst onto the internet scene with the video toaster. In the early 90s.
I remember the video.
Cue the Kiki Wipe, which is not on the TriCaster, unfortunately.
No. What's the Kiki Wipe? Is Kiki wiping from one
like
shot
Kiki
to another?
Like Kiki go-go dancing across
Wasn't
the
video toaster like an Amiga
It was
thing?
For the Amiga.
Amiga, right?
Yeah. It was like a proto TriCaster.
Because didn't they do like some Babylon 5 special effects on the
Babylon,
video toaster?
Basically, the original special effects for the Babylon 5 original first episode, premiere episode, was done. On a video
like
toaster.
The like the rendered the composited rendered chips and all that stuff. Oh, that's cool. I didn't know that.
Yeah,
I don't know if the final version, but at least one version was originally rendered on.
You guys should really go look up the promo video for the video toaster on YouTube. It's
I feel like Kiki's
fantastic.
Place, but I can't see her right.
And that
now.
Well, that was like Kiki's debut,
right? So she was like the model in the video, and she sort of became like their. Spokesperson for all of New Tech's They're the
makers of the TriCaster.
And then my understanding is that she kind of gathered a following on the internet.
That's pretty accurate.
Before there was really like, you know, memes or
YouTube and stuff like that. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't even know how a video like that was circulated.
Probably like Spirit of Christmas and all that kind of early stuff, like on Usenet, which we were talking about earlier.
Yeah.
All comes back around to Usenet, it turns out.
So I found this page that was dedicated to like tracking the history of Kiki and like where did she go? What is she doing now?
When is really weird. This video, for example, the one on this TriCaster, when do you think this was shot?
I don't know.
Is this Kiki 10 years ago?
No, maybe, I don't know, 5.
Okay.
And
like Patrick said, big Star Trek fan.
Oh,
So that's where things got weird. I was researching this page.
Clearly, that's the part where it gets weird.
I was researching this page, and I saw, you know, one of the links was Kiki's band, and you click on it.
Warp
11.
Haircut.
There she is. God. Yeah. She's in a Star Trek themed band based in Sacramento.
Wow, they even have an Elkaz website.
Yeah.
Well, this is where I went.
Went to see Kiki.
They had a performance.
Perform.
At the Blue Lamp. Nice. $10 cover charge.
Wow. Wait, so you were so obsessed with this person that you sought them out and went to see her band?
I had no idea who she was. I did not have Patrick's.
It's like the Carmen San Diego of video.
Yeah.
She's wearing Vulcan ears and everything.
And wow. Yeah, and I, you know, that guy posted on the forums, who is this? And I vowed to answer.
So this was a Star Trek themed
band.
Band?
Yeah.
Is there a Scissor Sisters video featuring Kiki too?
No.
Maybe. It yeah. Like so here's is, so the creepy website.
Describe the music.
Did it say her name was Kiki Stockholm there? Is
that Stockhammer.
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 Which is an awesome last name.
That's pretty cool.
That is a cool
especially
name.
Especially for somebody who's in a lot of stock video, Stockhammer as a name.
Nice. It looked like she was wearing Vulcan ears in that image.
Yeah, and a lot of leather. She's wearing leather. So the weird thing was.
Is she Romulan or Vulcan, do you think?
Well, I couldn't tell.
Hedwig just mean Romulan.
Tonight, this is like Halloween night, right?
Yeah.
Close
enough.
So they, instead of dressing up in Star Trek uniforms, they dressed up as Star Wars characters.
This is too good to be true.
And they rewrote all the lyrics to their songs to fit with Star Wars.
Did they play the Cantina Band song?
So their band was bumper music before they went on.
It was like original so Star Trek themed songs that they played?
Yeah. Okay. It's original music. They sound sort of like The Offspring and Eagles of Death Metal, like that kind of stuff.
All right.
They're actually, this is the most, the thing that surprised me the most, they're actually pretty good. So if you were in the Sacramento area.
But you didn't get the Star Trek experience.
I did not know. I got the Star Wars experience.
They
once a year. Also pretty awesome.
And if you go to the Warp 11 website, you can find them.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Warp 11.
So for Halloween, they flipped it and they did Star Wars. Basically.
Star Wars. Yeah.
That's crazy. So you're gonna have to go back and see the Star Trek.
What was the crowd like?
You know, like
all video producers.
Local bar. No, I think it was a lot of like a lot people knew the words
there anyway. Okay.
There were some people who were drinking there, and suddenly Comic Con rolled into their bar.
That had to be disconcerting.
Yeah. But my main reason for going.
Did you get her to autograph your TriCaster? Fuck yes!
Wow.
Nice.
Hold on, can we get that on the RoboCam? Is somebody in there who can work the RoboCam? Oh, that's amazing.
So we actually.
Joey's aiming the real camera.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, look at this. See, we don't have to do this. We don't have to move the camera while the shot's live, but we do it because we want to.
Yeah.
Keep it in deliberately lo-fi.
So that's going to hang in our control room.
That's rad.
That's pretty awesome.
How did you go about approaching her and asking her to do this? Were you nervous about that? Song?
Yes, because I didn't know.
Like,
what
you were more nervous
think.
Doing this than you were wandering around North Korea. I suspect
it was. They're both very frightened.
Were there girls there
in North Korea?
Well, either it works either way.
Or at a
Star Trek tribute band. Either way, it's a touch and go proposition.
Star Wars going to be any
girls there. It was pretty even split, actually.
Okay.
Yeah, maybe 60-40.
Okay.
There's a good bar scene in Sacramento.
Oh, I gotta imagine, yeah.
Did you walk around going, Nuke Nick?
What?
Speaking Klingon?
Wait, is this why you're in Sacramento? Did you go all the way to Sacramento for this
purpose?
Yeah. Wow. Yep.
This express purpose.
It's not that far. I mean, well, I
saw it's pretty
far. I used to chase bands literally from Boston to what's the town?
But East Coast distances and West Coast distances are completely different. It's all relative.
If I'll drive to Boston to go see a band on a Friday night, driving to Sacramento is like 90 minutes, unless it's ski season, in which case.
All right, so how was the interaction? Like, she's obviously doing a set. Like, how did you get her?
Well, I stayed to the end. They played for like 2 hours. They must have played almost all of their music.
A lot of Star Trek music.
It was good. And then she got off the stage, and some people came up to her and talked, and then I was like waiting in the back.
Holding the TriCaster panel. So
given that she was doing Star Wars, what was her getup?
So she was leather again, like a corset type thing, and then face painted like Darth Maul.
All right.
Did you get a photo?
Yeah. They're kind of grainy, but I have them on my phone. Yeah.
Interesting.
So, Drew
Scanlon, you live a life of adventure.
You know, I couldn't not do it. I looked at where Warp 11 was playing, and I'm like, that's. Yeah,
Did she think that you were weird for wanting her to sign your TriCaster?
I said, I'm sorry if this is a strange request, but I have the faceplate of a TriCaster for you to sign. And she just like, oh, awesome, and laughed. And
she was totally cool. First TriCaster.
Kiki is awesome. Kiki was really, really cool.
I mean, and just to be clear, the TriCaster is awesome too. Because it's a thing that's like, revolutionized the way we
850,
work.
Huh? You guys should try the 8000 model. Really knock your socks off. Like, totally fell into salesperson mode. It was great. It was amazing.
Yeah. Kiki.
Kiki Stockhammer, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, that's the story. God, that was a fantastic story. I apologize for ever doubting you, Drew Scanlon. Yeah.
I think with that, I really need to sleep.
That seems like a wise
you
choice
lucky
for you,
bastard.
Sir.
Yeah, this is two weekends in a row. I can't do it.
What, you got any secrets for us? You did 9 to 9, so that's a completely different.
Right.
Like, you. By the time you got to this point, you were on the home stretch. You were in deep into Halo 3.
Yeah. I mean, you just got to, like, mentally prepare yourself.
Steal your body.
Yeah.
Don't think about the time. Just push on.
Yeah.
That's unfortunate because we haven't done any preparation.
Yeah. Also,
of any kind.
If you could, I think getting sunlight in here would help you guys.
No, we can't do that. It'll fuck up the lights.
Even if it's a little bit.
No.
It would be nice.
Maybe a system of mirrors.
All this artificial light is really messing with me.
Well, but
you are our sunshine.
Pretend you're in Vegas. If you were in Vegas right now, you'd be in 12 hours into your first blackjack session.
Right, but that's the thing. In Vegas, there would be all kinds of other stimulus.
Can we get some oxygen?
We could take turns pretending to be the dealer. Give each other away.
I have cards in my bag. I don't have 7 decks, but I mean, if we're
we do have a challenge for you guys coming up.
It's coming up in half hour,
30 minutes,
whatever. We're going to do a mini bricked. We're going to do a Lego race, which is the nerdiest thing that's happened so far tonight. Drew Scanlon, thank you so much for coming
by. Thank you, Patrick.
You're dodging the,
nice to meet you.
You're dodging the Mad Libs bullet, but I'll take that, or Normal take it for you later.
All right.
So thank you, sir.
Thank you. Good luck.
Ladies and gentlemen, Drew Scanlon, triumphbomb.com, Life with Kiki.
That's right.
So, yeah. And hey, if people want to see North Korea photos, where is the blog post on Giant Bomb?
Yeah, it's on my my Giant Bomb page. My username's Drewbert.
Drewbert.
And if you're a premium member, you can Drew goes to North Korea.
It was a great. It's worth paying.
I basically
up for
just
the month
narrate
to watch,
my
it was a great
my
video. Yeah.
Yeah.
It was like slideshows usually kind of suck, but that was awesome.
Thank you.
Thanks, Drew. See you later, man. Get some rest.
Yeah, that was rad.
And then there were 4.
I mean, like between
Patrick,
between poking around behind like the. You know, the Iron Curtain and seeking out weird internet meme people, you know, in Sacramento, Star Trek tribute bands. I feel like Drew's like my new journalistic hero.
Drew doesn't.
He's got like all the bases covered.
How far would you go to seek out someone who you have some like distant connection to just from the internet?
Well, I mean, you know, I did drive all the way to Los Gatos to meet Steve Wozniak when he was camping out outside the Apple Store.
That's like 45 minutes. Though.
You regret not coming with me.
I absolutely regret
you could,
that.
You could have
it's
done
one
it.
Of the great regrets of my life.
And it's
he'll be at Maker Faire.
I'm very glad that I did it because he was a very friendly, avuncular fellow and very gracious and just
avuncular
a nice guy.
Avuncular is exactly the right word.
Yeah, absolutely the right word. And I'm always worried when you meet people like that. You know, oftentimes you don't want to approach them because you feel like if I have a bad interaction, it's just going to soil my view of that person forever. But, you know, when I had enough information about Wozniak,
And other people, I had plenty of people said to me, oh, no, he's great. Trust
he's
me.
He's kind and gentle. Yeah, he'll be really nice. And encouraging. And
yes, he'll be gentle with you. And he was. He was super friendly.
He hover-handed you, kind of, but not really.
No, there was no hover hand.
Wasn't there hover hand? Oh, it you was standing a full, right next to him. Oh, that's right.
It was a nice, a real hug.
Full embrace.
Yeah. So I got to meet Jobs and Wozniak. That's one of my little... I collected all the Pokemons of that set.
Wow. What did they
evolve
into?
Two very rare sets.
I guess it's... yeah. Too soon.
Yeah. I'd definitely trade my Paul Allen for Steve Wozniak. Excuse me, Steve Jobs.
What was... when did you meet Paul Allen?
Paul Allen, old and Vulcan Ventures, which owned Tech
TV. Oh, yeah, you guys. That's right. Yeah, he was your boss. Boss's 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 boss.
Yeah, our CEO brought him around, basically showing off the horses.
Hey, look at where your money's going.
Yeah, pretty much. And, you know, this is Patrick Norton. You host the Screensavers. And it was like fish handshake. Didn't look you in the eye.
Oh.
Yeah, it was like... So
well, he owns a basketball team now, so he got what was coming to him.
Yeah. Let's just say if you ever get bought by Vulcan Ventures, run.
Okay. You know, I guess the last vestiges of Tech TV shut down yesterday when they finished the last of the... I mean, all that stuff...
Shuts down at the end of the year, so...
Well, okay.
Yeah, so Extended Play... GeForce is basically shutting down Extended Play and Attack of the Show at the end of the year.
Extended Play ran all the way from, like, the GameSpot ZDTV days, kind
they
of, didn't
basically
it?
Gutted a bunch of people from the Screensavers to help launch it. Well, they didn't... Later on, they pulled up some people from the Screensavers to work on Extended Play. But, yeah, it was Extended Play and the Screensavers were the two most popular shows.
It's kind of old school that you called it Extended Play, because, of course, most of us just know it as X-Play these days.
Yeah, I mean, it was Extended Play when it started, and I never quite caught up to X-Play. Although, you know, that was 10 years ago.
Now, something that I don't know if this came up today, but when I heard that news, and obviously it's very sad news, does that also mean that the... Oh, no, because the VGA is a spike, right? That's a whole other thing.
It's a different thing.
So they'll probably keep doing that.
I don't think anybody would be really that upset if they stopped doing
But there
VGAs.
Isn't really... That was the only real kind of, like, on-TV games programming. It's all pretty much gone now, right? Because X-Play and Attack of the Show is pretty much all there was.
But at the same time, how many people watch the Dota finals and the StarCraft championships and all that kind of stuff? So, I mean, clearly there's an audience for that. It's just worldwide, not...
Yeah, and the reality is so much...
And not ad-driven. It's also
so much of games,
right.
games coverage on the web has now become video anyway. Yeah. That content is there. It's just, you know, on a different...
It's impossible to compete with YouTube and the major websites in terms of... Basically, everybody is either has a major website or releases content on YouTube, and it's instantaneous, and it's exactly what people want, and they get it now. And
do you think that's what was the death of those shows then?
You know, I got a text from a friend of mine that was who was one of the producers I worked with for a bunch of years before he took over as the senior. He's like an exec. I remember like him being an intern slash production assistant. He's now like an executive producer over a bunch of shows there, or at least Attack of the Show. And he was like, hey, you know, we're wrapping up, and wanted to ask me about something. And they basically got the news this morning. So, you know, I assume it's some sort of major change in how they're going to, you know, what the channel is going to do. Like, they're going to spin the channel to whatever.
The thing I read was it's going to be more GQ Esquire, young men with style.
I mean, so it's the sophisticated spike.
No more Ninja Warrior?
I don't know.
Oh, I love Ninja Warrior.
I gotta say, I don't like a lot of what Spike TV is, but I did recently discover Ninja Warrior, and it's a pretty good show.
You know, my wife loves Ninja Warrior.
Well, the problem with Ninja Warrior is they're not going to do it anymore in Japan, so there is no more content.
So it's the Iron Chef.
But they
situation.
Have a pretty long history of it, right? They could just rerun what they have forever.
They could just rerun forever. So many seasons.
So as somebody who hasn't had cable for several years, what is Ninja Warrior?
Whoa. I thought I was the only person who did not know.
You didn't know what this was?
Until like a year ago, a year and a half ago.
I'm so disappointed.
It's got nothing to do with being a ninja. It's just basically an extreme obstacle course show.
Oh, okay.
It's an incredibly difficult obstacle.
So I know it intimately. I just don't know the name.
Fiendishly designed obstacle courses that you have to be
usually
super agile
being
and
in a pond
super
and
fucking fit to complete.
No, it's not. That's a different one.
Okay, that's a different one.
So this one is a lot of like balance and strength tests, and they're usually arranged in really brutal senses.
So do you remember, you know, in the end of American Gladiators, there's always that one obstacle course that was like the really
with the tennis ball
American
not,
Gladiators
not the tennis ball with the we have to like do run across the pulley, and
that show was so rigged.
The final elimination
you don't say
right no, with no, the rock climbing and everything. this is like the Japanese version of that, where the competition is nothing but that.
Got it.
And
so it's not the super goofy one that I'm thinking.
It's
of.
Not goofy.
Are
at all.
You thinking of Wipeout?
Yes.
So it's like a serious version of that.
Like,
so,
like their one of their strength challenges will be doing chin-ups on a bar that's not attached to anything and is on a stair-step pyramid.
It's called the salmon.
So you start at the bottom and you chin up. Throw the bar up on the next ladder, and then the people will
right,
do
yeah.
three at a time.
The Green Arrow remake that just showed up on the WB has a big scene with that in it.
So that's what
you and I are the people who watch that on iTunes.
And so they have, they have seasons, and they invite people, and a lot of people. It's almost comical. Some people
like
don't do
Olympic
take it seriously.
And
some people who are professional strongmen try it.
Right.
But really, it's like the dudes who are professional fishermen. And it's fishermen by day, and at night they recreate the Ninja Warrior obstacle course in their
there are guys in their tiny little Japanese apartments have
creative ways
built
to have
in miniature
all
the Ninja Warrior
all
course
the challenges.
So they can practice on it.
And they have a part of the course where you the cliffhanger section with scale, the side of a cliff, but all you have is
it's basically friction. Enough of a ledge
to
just barely cling on by your fingernails.
Yeah.
It's pretty brutal. It's exhausting just watching these guys. And these guys are absolutely at the peak of physical
and
fitness.
No guaranteed winner. So there have only been...
Not everyone completes the course.
Yeah, at the end of the season, sometimes no one wins.
Is it on Netflix or iTunes?
What?
It's on Amazon Streaming.
Amazon Streaming.
Old episodes, I believe.
So what G4 does...
Maybe it's on Hulu. I can't remember.
It licenses the Japanese version. So they have the American distribution rights, and then they have the dubbing. So
Is it good dubbing, or is it they want to kick things dubbing?
It's probably kick things dubbing.
Yeah.
But it's something you can listen to with the sound off. Just to be clear.
But yeah, I wasn't... Norm would talk about it a lot, and I'm like, I really don't want to have to put Spike on.
So I tried.
But I was channel surfing. Norm really talks about the show. I'll give it 5 minutes, and I ended up getting really sucked into it because it's pretty impressive.
I tried to watch that literally 4 or 5 years ago, the Japanese version, and was well, we have one TV in the house because I don't like multiple. I don't think it's necessary. And
you got the thing. That's cool.
Issues. I like that one.
But the upshot is that there's strong competition for the TV in my household, and I usually see it because I'm just as happy going to the other room playing a video game or farting around on the internet or something. So earlier this year, Gina says, "Oh my God, there's this amazing show on TV. We should totally watch it." And I said, "What is it?" She said, "Oh, it's called Ninja Warrior." And I said, "Are you're talking? You want to watch now the American shitty remake of the Japanese show that we were trying to watch?" I was like, "It's like an Iron Chef, but with an obstacle course instead of food. Why would you not want to watch this? This is an amazing piece of it's
entertainment.
It's culture.
They tried to bring it to America.
It's like foreign cinema.
They tried to have an American.
They put it
show.
In Venice,
kind of like Top Gear,
but it was terrible because it was
or Friends.
It's sad when they have the American version. All the guys are like the bros, the workout, the Venice Beach guys who try to do it. And when they do it in Japan, it's all the earnest students and the fishermen who do it.
Right.
And it's a totally different vibe.
There's
so much honor.
Stupidity.
So much honor.
So much honor.
Well, no, but it's the level, American television, nobody wants to trust that drama can come from anything from very staged memes. And it's incredibly frustrating to watch stuff like that.
Yeah. What was the name of the Japanese game show that they brought over here and completely fucked up with the giant foam hole in the wall? It's the worst idea ever. It's a giant styrofoam wall on a slide, and the slide moves towards you. And if you don't make the right pose to fit through the hole,
you get knocked into the soup. Yeah.
Right. And it's a team game. You can put two or three people on the slots.
So you need two people.
And they have to make these ridiculous poses.
Yeah.
Or else
I'm pretty sure that there was a Kinect.
There is a Kinect version
of that
game.
But the promo they always show is this, unfortunately overweight contestant. And the hole is tiny. And this is no way. It just knocks them into the soup.
Yeah. That's the kind of TV there's no fake drama there. You know how it's going to end up. Is the wall, is the hole, it either works or it doesn't.
Yeah, it's just watching people get knocked into the water.
Yeah, it's the worst part of TV.
One of the great joys.
We need a dunk tank for OCTOBERKAST next year.
I'd be down for that.
How are we doing with the donations? We should do a check-in and also let people know where they can donate. They're just joining us. I think some people in Australia are tuning in now.
Guys, we're above $9,000.
And again, that's not counting the extra $1,000 for the pistol that was donated. So we are actually over $10,000.
I assume the pistol is a toy, it's 3D rendering? Or it's, yeah. No, no, like no. Burger
1911 SC. It's a Mass Effect prop replica that was cool. Commissioned and designed especially for us. It has tested logos on it. And so it's very cool. One of a kind. And we got $1,500 for that. So that was pretty cool.
Yeah, so Bill Doran, who runs Punish Props, made a awesome pistol for us, and I think we have all of everything with Mass Effect in my name here. I probably missed it. Oh, here we go. So that's it.
Oh, that's so cool.
Yeah, it looks really.
Yeah,
good.
I mean it's a legitimate like he builds the props. He builds molds of the guns from the games that he's into. Mm-hmm. This is the gun that he happened to use in Mass Effect, the same one that I use most of the game. Then he casts them out of resin, and he does one of the things that you know kind of separates the people who are really awesome at building this stuff and the people who are merely just good is the weathering, and he does right. A great job with the weathering, so yeah. It looks like a real, it looks like something that's seen some use. You know, you killed some aliens with that thing.
So far we auctioned off two signed copies of the Walking Dead video game, which we got $400 each for. Pretty good. $1,500 yeah. For the pistol,
I think we're hanging pretty strong.
20 minutes left on the gear heart. Where are we up to on that?
No, we have an hour and 20 minutes because we said 6 okay. O'clock. So,
all right. What's the top bid on that currently?
I wish I had a home key on my laptop. $220 is where the heart is right now.
That's
Eric
pretty good.
Is the top bid, and he's trying to stay up long enough to see the results. But if I cannot, I will give in the morning when I am awake. Thanks, guys. Keep up the good work. And if you want to bid, if you want to beat $220, just to be clear, what we're selling is a 3D printed heart that I went and bondoed and painted with red enamel, so it's very shiny and red. It's imperfect. It has some charm.
As all hearts are.
Yes. But it's not broken, the top bid is $220. If you want the heart, then you need to beat that by sending an email to tips@tested.com with gear heart and then the bid in the subject line.
It's amazing. That is something that came out of a machine. Basically.
I downloaded that from the internet, and yeah. It is a physical thing now. And then I painted it.
I wanted to ask you, when you were talking about it before, how many 3D printers do you have in your life right now? Between all of you, I mean, like,
it's an obsession with these guys.
We have the one that in active use.
Okay. Yeah, so the thingamatic is still functional, and I fire it up occasionally. But the thing that the speed increase and the resolution increase on the replicator from the mm-hmm. thingamatic is such that it's kind of like it's not worth fooling around with a lot of times.
What did you think of the Kickstarter project around the 3D printer that was up this
the
week?
Formlabs
the
one?
Yeah.
It's amazing. We saw it at Maker Faire in New York a few weeks ago mm-hmm. in action.
It's not for you and me for the home.
It's
outside of the barrier to entry on price. Or is
yeah,
it,
it's
or
like
is
$2,400,
like,
I
because
think.
Because the materials they use and the process they use, it's not something like the MakerBot where you can watch it being printed and plug it off the build platform. You got to cure it.
Mm-hmm. No, you know, it's just a rinsing process. So the thing you have to do is clean the you clean the plastic off. There's some solvent issues and stuff like that.
Chemicals.
The chemicals are not particularly bad, but it's stuff you want to wear gloves to use. Okay. You rinse it in isopropyl to wash it off, and that solves it. They actually give you a little kit when you buy mm-hmm. the printer that has like dipping baskets and all that
stuff. So it's more for the garage and not for the living room.
Okay. But you were starting describing it, I'm like, oh, so we need an industrial area.
No. You can do it in the garage, no problem, like in your workspace. But like MakerBot, it's like the family can use it.
Yeah, but the resolution on that is so...
So it's like beams of light. Yeah. Basically, it's the width of the laser mm-hmm. and the focusing time on that. So the way that works, it's a laser.
Let's just stop, right? Because you're so far into this, it doesn't really sound miraculous to you anymore. You're printing 3D objects with a laser in your garage. Let's slow down and talk about that for a second.
Yeah. I've been printing stuff for 2.5 years now, right?
Right.
Every week. We print something, and usually it's something really dumb. Occasionally, it's something that's surprisingly cool.
Right.
The heart was really cool. The fact that I can take data
mm-hmm.
and turn that into a physical object in a few hours without having to go to the store or mill something or have real skills is amazing. And while it's not to like a life-changing thing, the thing that amazes me, and you walk around Maker Faire, so you know. When I see a kid who's 5 years old and walks around Maker Faire and is excited because he's at Maker Faire and there's a lot of cool stuff, but isn't blown away by the fact that he just interacted with a robot or she interacted with a robot. I think what the kids who are growing up, who are going to grow up with this stuff, it's there's a strong analog to the kids my generation, your generation, that grew up with computers, mm-hmm. and the kids this generation that are growing up with access to CAD and CAM software and mm-hmm. 3D printers from a very young age. And I think they're going to be doing stuff that is miraculous by today's standards in 20 years.
So how long before we see like a $200 3D printer?
You can buy them right now. There's variants of the Cupcake, which is the printer directly mm-hmm. behind you, that people are selling kits for that are $400, $500. They're small print size. So the right. sacrifice is small print size. Mm-hmm. But what the Ultabot is what I'm thinking about. I think that's $500. It's basically a guy who took the original Cupcake design that MakerBot made. It's open source.
Right.
He updated the printhead with a newer version of the printhead that's easier to maintain, better resolution, all that kind of stuff. Changed the drivetrain on the printer itself, and so he looked at the stuff that made the newer versions of 3D printers, both MakerBot and other RepRap printers and some other stuff entirely. And pulled the best of that into mm-hmm. a relatively small, still kind of cupcake sized print package, and he sells those kits relatively inexpensively. So, it's literally the transition that's starting to happen now is the transition from dudes in their garages soldering mm-hmm. boards onto chips like the old Sunnyvale Silicon Valley computer right. clubs, from which came HP, well not HP but Apple and a bunch of early desktop computer companies.
It was, I gotta say, it was a little surreal to like turn a corner at CES and be like, MakerBot.
Yeah.
Whoa, MakerBot's at
CES.
But
you know, they were in a corner in the South Hall at CES. Mm-hmm. Next year, they're gonna be in a much better place.
Yeah.
I mean, if anybody
everywhere
knows
in any.
We'll be there.
Well, yeah, we will. Well, I will.
So I think, it's still hobbyist now. Mm-hmm. Especially if you want to get to the more affordable
right.
products.
MakerBot 2
is still
is
$2,000. Mm-hmm. Less than 3 years, you're going to see them a lot of 3D printers.
Well, and the thing that's happening is now we're getting to the point that people that have specific needs, like designers, or right. they can. It's in $2,500, $3,000 isn't outside the
business expense. It's a MacBook Pro,
right? Yeah. And for maybe a 3D printer for the kitchen, just for kitchen stuff,
right?
Yeah. So cool. That the decrease in cost of PLA. The other big thing about that Formlabs printer is the cost of the resin is pretty high. It's I think it's $100, $120, $130 a quart or a liter rather,
right?
Compared to $50 a kilogram for ABS or PLA mm-hmm. spools. So you're going to spend a little bit more material. There's a little bit less waste because you don't have to do quite as much support material and stuff like that because mm-hmm. of the way that structure works. And the other benefit is their software is a little bit different. So because they have that really incredibly fine resolution, they can do supporting structure that just is literally tiny, tiny, tiny chunks connected to the main building. So they can build things that are uneven surfaces, which is a pretty significant challenge on the MakerBot today and most of the additive, the more traditional additive processes. Mm-hmm. I'm super interested to see people are coming up with crazy new stuff all the time. Those guys have a real fidelity advantage because they really only have one precision axis, the one that lifts the platform up out of the goop, and the laser is all electronically steered and you focus it and that determines your resolution. So I'm really interested to see what that goes. I would love to buy one. I don't think I can justify $3,000 since we can't really shoot it that well because you have to keep the orange hood on
right.
to keep the laser out of people's eyes and the UV out of the goop and I think
this is what USB cameras were invented for.
Well, maybe
until the laser hits the camera and blows out the sensor.
I'm fine with that. We can get more GoPros or whatever. But the problem is there's not that much space inside that thing. We have this crazy wide angle shot from
You just need a bigger hood.
The GoPros, though, there's some more miraculous technology. The little action cameras.
I should point out in an odd coincidence, the guy that runs PR for GoPro, I played rugby with in high school. So props to Rick, but even if it wasn't for my friendship with Rick, it's really fun watching. Like it was actually I was like, oh my goodness, 4K, and then I read the specs on the 4K.
Yeah, like, 14 frames a second. Or something. Yeah, okay.
But so it's 2K or really amazing 1080p
or 240 hertz 1080p.
But
right?
Size and weight. I mean, they're made for sports and extreme stuff, but it's like spy gear.
Yeah, well, it's amazing. Like we use them at Revision 3. I know guys who've used them for desert racing, and they take a horrendous amount of abuse.
Oh yeah, I mean, if you look at technology, if you're looking at something that can take a beating, and you can completely disrespect those things,
mm-hmm.
and they hold up incredibly well.
Yeah.
They're great devices. So
yeah, we loaned one of ours out, actually, unfortunately, and somebody brought it back with a scratched lens. So.
Oh, that's bad.
Yeah.
You got to leave it in the case. The cases are disposable for a reason.
I still don't understand how they manage that, but, you know.
I mean, maybe if you got some sand in there or something, you could do bad things, but... But yeah, no, the 3D printing, I mean, are you, your kids are still a little bit young for it, but I assume that at some point, I mean, if you look at what we were spending on PCs 10 years ago,
right.
$500, $1,000, $1,500 for a 3D printer is not an unreasonable expense if they'll use it.
Let me finish, like, getting all the basics done on the house. Well, it's funny, it's one of those things where it's like, you know, would I like to get one? Absolutely. Does he have the patience for it right now and the ability to like, design stuff in 3D? No. But at this point, we're still, like, really classic crafting, you know, glue and scissors.
Yeah,
and,
of course.
You know, using power tools with me or you know, it's kind of fun to integrate him into all the classic stuff, you know. And there's kind of be this point where the affordability and the ease of use meet something. It's probably right by the time he's 6 or 7.
Yeah.
I think.
Well, and look at – and the other amazing thing that's happened is that the 3D – creation software has become very attainable.
Right.
You know, you're looking at Google SketchUp, which is free. Autodesk releases almost everything that they make as free for educational, for non-commercial use, which is amazing. So if at that point you put a kid in front of that, they can just noodle around with it.
I'm not trying to slag on Autodesk, but it's an incredibly savvy move for a company that makes its money off of software licenses to be like, you know what, we can give it away or they'll steal it. Let's give it away and create our market.
Honestly, if Photoshop had done that 20 years ago, nobody would pirate Photoshop.
Bingo.
I mean,
and there would be a lot fewer, you know, $50 photo apps out there.
Right. I mean, PaintShop Pro and Pixelmator and all those apps that are fantastic and rose up specifically because most people don't need Photoshop. They need something that can crop and do light retouching and clone. And tilt, pretty much.
I still remember, like, the first time I saw paint.net, and I'm like, I'm never buying another photo editing software for Windows again. I'm done.
That's it. Yeah, and now you can do that on your iPad for $5, something similar.
Or free.
As the case may be. I think the neat thing about the 3D stuff is that you don't have to buy a 3D printer in order to build 3D models. And then if you want to see how it works, you can send off to Shapeways and places like that, and they'll print your designs for, I mean, a fairly expensive cost. Or you can, you know, find friends who have a 3D printer or Hackerspace or, you know, whatever. There's a lot of, it's an amazing, when I walk around Maker Faire and I see kids that are walking around without wonder because they're meeting robots, but just wonder because they're like, oh, hey, that's the third robot I've seen today. I'm incredibly jealous of kids who are 5 years old today.
Yeah, so. No, we've taken Seamus to every Maker Faire since he's been born, and it's been really fun to watch him go from being, like, you know, small bundled creature in a stroller to, like, actively being like,
I can't imagine things. So what kind of stuff does he, what are the big hits?
Yes.
Just the whole thing.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, the vehicles are a really big draw for a, you know, 4 or 5 year old boy, and all of the light sculptures inside, and, you know, giant 22 segment, you know, illuminated dragons that roll around on golf courts, and rockets and planes,
driving
and planes
cupcakes
and rockets. The cupcakes. I mean, I'm you know, freaking 42, and I still see the cupcakes. I'm just like, this is, I love these.
They, I want to drive a happy cupcake. Yeah,
it's, I want to go to the playa with a cupcake, you know, just because it's such a, if anybody ever been to Burning Man, or just, you ever been to a playa? Playa is basically a dry lake bed, so 100 miles, and just the idea of somebody tooling around in a cupcake in the middle of one of the least hospitable environments on the planet just always makes me giggle my ass off.
It's real weird. We live in a weird time.
Yeah, or we make our time weird, so.
How are you guys doing over there?
Doing
awfully quiet on that side,
like,
of the table.
The same as when you last asked me, except with that much extra time added on.
Very good.
You know,
I'm very glad you have your laptop, though.
Why are you glad about that?
Yeah, let's keep helping. Visual stimuli. Put down the banhammer, and you got.
Are you banning people still?
I'm plenty stimulated. Okay. Am I what?
You're banning people? Oh, well, are there people being bad?
It's fun to ban.
First person to put meconium.
You
on
made
the board,
mistake of giving
banned.
Me mod powers on like tested some time ago, and I've you know.
If you ban them, they're banned permanently. You know, yeah. Just be gentle.
Someone's got to be the
touch. I might come back and unban and apologize to a bunch of people tomorrow.
No.
Patrick, I know you have a wedding to officiate later today, so I don't want
seriously?
To keep you.
Seriously?
Yes. Holy shit.
I know. Talk about manliest man in tech.
You continue to be the manliest man in tech. It's just like burning the candle at both ends. Just
it's
don't
fun.
Give a fuck. I love it.
I
somehow get it all done.
You know, I'll sleep when I'm dead, dude. There's just a lot of exciting stuff going on. And, you know, it gets me out of a, you know, afternoon of moving concrete out of the backyard as we...
Did somebody pave your backyard and you had to jackhammer the whole thing up?
No, it's not quite that bad. Somebody did some really creative... I don't know where some of these pieces of concrete... So there's some really funny stuff. I live in Alameda, which a third of Alameda Island was a naval base.
Yeah.
And so one of the funny things you see on houses of a certain age that haven't been touched is, like, battleship paint. Which is not the most toxic substance on the planet, but is like apparently it's like it has like 8 times as much lead because that helped it resist rusting that much more.
Awesome.
Yeah, and you stumble across things where it's like obviously somebody was selling stuff at the back fence of the naval base of the naval air station.
Yeah.
But in this case, there's just a lot of random. There's a lot of usable yard that is under concrete, and the concrete saw action is not quite there. This is just the smaller stuff they used. You know, 8-inch concrete. 4 foot long, 10-inch, 10-inch by 10-inch concrete troughs from some sort of water project that are being used to delineate the garden on the back wall. Yeah, literally like little mini
That's
culverts.
Real weird.
Yeah. Not as weird as the random like 6-foot by 3-foot slab of concrete in one corner of the yard. Or
sometimes you just had some extra concrete left over to pour, right?
I can see what they were doing where they were creating edges. And there's, you know, I cut down 2 camilla trees last weekend that were a mess. And all of a sudden, like we got like another 70 square feet in our backyard, which sounds really minuscule. But
no, Northern California, that's a lot.
It's a lot, yeah. And it's just, so I'm getting out of a day of horrendous back-wrenching work, so I'm okay with that.
For the kids.
For the kids.
For the kids.
Or the wedding. Or actually for the kids.
Both the kids and the wedding.
Are conspiring.
If we can, whatever concrete. We can do to help, man.
Yeah. Well, I'll be moving concrete tomorrow, so.
Tomorrow's Sunday now, isn't it? Wow, that's
oh, no,
that happened.
I take it back. Actually, we will have the Great Pumpkin Expedition tomorrow.
Oh, so do you take the kids to the pumpkin patch and do that whole thing? Because we didn't have those when I was a child. That seems like a new invention. Maybe a Northern California thing.
Well, so Half Moon Bay is like the pumpkin capital of North America.
Yeah.
But we're actually going kind of the opposite direction to a different pumpkin.
Yeah, we went to a pumpkin patch. We went down the PCH down to kind of, I don't know if it was exactly in Half Moon Bay, but it was certainly in that area. And you're right, there's a lot of pumpkin patches down there. We went to an insane one that had like a crazy wicker man King Kong, and there were like medieval knight sword fight demonstrations.
Are there good mazes
like
there?
Probably. There's actually some political battle going on down in Half Moon Bay. At what point you go from a farm to an amusement park?
Oh, yes. The farms, like, they need to compete, so they need to these attractions.
Is that why the guy in Pacifica now has like a carnival stuff and ponies and all sorts of crazy stuff?
Yes.
Yeah, there's a bunch of insanely overambitious pumpkin patches.
They run these events past Halloween, though.
There was a pretty cool haunted house as part of it. Like I said, they had like Renaissance fed sword
fight.
Well,
the pumpkin patch, it turns straight into the Christmas tree lot now, right? Like they clear out the pumpkins, and then 6 weeks later they bring in the trees.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then the rest of the year it's just a vacant lot.
So, you know, when I grew up, we didn't have.
Oh, here we go.
When we wanted a pumpkin for Thanksgiving,
I just covered the next hour
for Halloween, we just went to the grocery store and paid a buck, and they gave you a pumpkin. And then
you know
went
you can still do that today.
Yeah,
Trader Joe's or Safeway.
The whole thing's just a giant. It's the part of the pumpkin industrial complex.
Well, but it actually
okay. Pumpkin industrial.
I don't buy this, man.
Well, what's weird is it started. I mean, literally started out that there was like you know the people that a whole bunch of people that raised pumpkins in Half Moon Bay.
Yeah. And, well, that's legitimate. That's honest work.
Like a
honest pumpkin folk.
Pumpkin, right. Pumpkin folk are good folk, man. I got no beef with the pumpkin people.
And at some point, some guy was like, hey, you know, I don't know. He bought a train at an auction, like a little kid train at an auction, and installed that. So you could go, like, buy a ticket for the kid train when you're getting your pumpkins. And then, you know what I mean? And then it kind of escalates into more and more stuff where, like,
what
you go
Eisenhower
to get pumpkins.
Warned us against.
Yeah, but it's fun. I mean, it's relatively – it can be really irritating when your kid's like, oh, you know, I want to do the ride one more time, and at this point you've been there for 4 hours. You're like $40 in the hole.
But is this like the Christmas tree thing where you're looking for the – like you're holding up the tree and you turn around to make sure that all the sides are exactly right, and you have to get the specific brand that's probably the most expensive breed of tree? Or is this like you just go and like, yeah, that pumpkin looks okay?
Some pumpkin farms are about finding the perfect pumpkin, and there's certainly an array of pumpkins at all the pumpkin farms. Other pumpkin farms are more about – you know, feeding your kid hot chocolate and trying to get them to spend as much money on tickets for random goat petting operations as possible.
Okay. And do you thump
animal petting
pumpkin
stuff
before
and like
you...
pony rides are the saddest things?
It depends. Goats can be a lot of fun with small children.
Goats are, yeah, they're the same size, right?
Yeah.
They have freaky eyes too.
Pony rides, I can definitely see, like, you know,
the one that spin on the around the circle.
Yeah,
and
that always.
Yeah, hay rides are a big part of the pumpkin patch experience.
Yeah, hay rides I'm good with. Pony rides in general are kind of like really depressing.
Hmm. Yeah, I feel bad for the pony.
You just walk in a circle all day long.
Which, you know, maybe, you know, it could be a Zen exercise for them.
Horses are pretty dumb.
I wonder if there's
we
a
had
kid
horses when I was a kid. They're not super smart.
Yeah, that's the problem when you actually have a smart horse. It just screws everything up.
When you have a smart horse, you have real problems. Because then the best horse is the horse that walks out of the stable and is like, hey, where am I? What's this? What's that blue thing up there? Oh, you want me to go, okay, I weigh 3,000, 2,500 pounds, and I'm super dumb. So it's good that I do exactly what you tell me to. That's the best horse in the world.
Yeah. Yeah. Then there's that other horse.
The smart horses. Patrick, thank you so much for coming out.
My pleasure.
We will see you.
Yeah, that was great. As always, one of our best guests.
The early morning star. We didn't even talk about Surface. We'll have to do that at some other point in the not too distant future.
You can come on Tekzilla and talk
about
it.
Okay. We'll see you on. You guys record on Thursday, right?
Patrick. Thanks, Patrick. Great to see you.
Drive safe back, and good luck with the officiation of the ceremonies this evening.
Yeah,
and give our regards to the the happy couple.
I will do my best.
Joey's looking a bit worse for wear.
Joey, how are your arms feeling?
Should I leave you the coffee?
We will take advantage of it. We're well stocked on black blood.
Yeah, you look like I.
It's almost time. You look like you might need that today more than we do. Yeah.
There's no coffee.
Is it time for black blood?
Well, I don't think I want to touch that stuff. I just wanted like a regular cup of American coffee.
Just put some water in it; it'll be fine.
Half and half.
I think it's a mistake.
Half and half. You'll have to go with the Black Death.
Because I worry that I could end up getting wacky and like telling Adam Savage to fuck off or something.
That's this is a perfectly
that's
valid
not,
point.
That's not how we want to play.
We're
Adam leaves.
No Mad Libs.
Not how we
want to
play.
Just to be clear,
no Mad Libs.
Yeah. Norm has a look of danger in his eyes.
We'll get you the black blood.
I think you should have some black
blood. I will. So I'm going to the kitchen right now.
I want you to be the guinea pig.
Yeah, absolutely.
Would you bring me
the
black blood?
And if you look okay after about 30 minutes, maybe I'll follow you. But I'm not jumping in without some kind of...
Hey, Gary, I'm going to tell you something that's going to make you really happy or depress you horribly. We're 55 minutes away from the halfway mark.
Yeah, it's depressing me.
So the
I
good
figured
news
that
is,
out earlier. I did the math in my head.
You did.
It didn't make me happy. I didn't think about... I'm like... I often think of myself as a lot like Buddha.
It's very kind of... take the world as it goes.
Well, you know, I've got you know,
you've got a
belly.
Of a paunch.
But, you know, Buddha said, I do not see what has been done.
Uh-huh.
I only see what is yet to be done. And that's how I feel about... That's pretty fucking deep, right?
For where I am right now, I don't understand exactly what you said.
Dropping some Zen wisdom.
Yeah.
It means that I don't rest on my laurels and I'm not satisfied with what I've accomplished. I'm always just thinking about what still needs to be
accomplished. Always look to the east. You're looking for the sunrise.
Okay. So I'm not thinking about 11 hours down and that's or whatever it is. Yeah, 11 hours.
11 hours down.
11 hours
13
down.
13 hours to go.
I'm thinking about, 13 hours still to go.
So you're
and again, the next 12 hours aren't the same as the first. It's you're
once
doing
the sun
it.
Comes up, it all gets better.
I'm telling you, we're going to regret I had this plan. It was one thing to start at 6 p.m. I was like, okay, great. Well, maybe I'll be able to like sleep a little bit during the afternoon and start the day late. That was never going to happen.
I took a 30-minute nap, and then the FedEx guy woke me up.
See, that nap could end up paying dividends for you later on.
You know, a wise man once said that the night is always darkest just before the dawn.
Don't try to do what I do. You can't pull
that. Was that what?
A wise man.
I don't even know what that's from.
A wise man once said what? That it's always darkest.
The sun is always darkest just before the dawn.
Yeah.
I think that's from a comic book movie.
Yeah, I think that's just kind of a cliche.
I think that's from Dark Knight or something, isn't it? The internet will tell me.
I was dropping like Buddhist Zen wisdom on you. Yeah, you give me that fucking platitude back.
That's what I do.
You got to raise your game.
Yep. People are saying Gary Buddha doesn't exist. That's from Bad Writing 101. I'm not going to read any more chat comments.
Don't read the chat.
What time is sunrise?
I don't fucking know. What difference does it fucking make? We can't see it.
I was asking Siri.
Oh.
7:29 a.m. So we have 2 hours and 29 minutes till sunrise. I thought it was going to be sooner than that. I'll be perfectly honest. I thought that was going to be helpful information, not something depressing that made me want to cut myself.
Plenty of time yet.
Let's... Oh, hey, it's 5 a.m. I don't want all of those. I just want one.
Oh, shit.
That
looks highly illegal, dangerous.
You gotta take it back. We can't leave all this out here. It has to be safe refrigerated. I can't work the Ziploc. Which one's
don't
which?
Take the Black Death.
Are they
not all the same?
No, they're not the same. They're different.
Some things more dangerous.
Oh, there's
than,
one that says death.
Others.
I don't want death.
Don't take death.
What's you, is you death? Take like the super back. Concentrated
put it
version.
Back in the
put one on
okay. Should I give him a death? This one says Ethiopia. I like Ethiopian coffee. This one says Malabar. That's good too. It's bricked is on the schedule next.
Oh no! Okay.
This is going to be exciting. I'm going to scooch. So I have. A
I was
going to
say, like, do we really want to use such a signature piece of content in the middle of the night when few people are watching? But I kind of feel like we need something strong to get us through this.
The night is always darkest just before the dawn, Gary. That's the lesson here. Moving all this Microsoft Surface crap out of the way.
We have actually maintained a pretty decent audience. Even now, in the middle of the fucking night, we've got over 1,000 people watching this garbage.
Yeah, I mean, we have it's a hardcore commitment here from a very significant... Oh, hey! That's a good idea, Joey. Joey's been... So, let's see, what, about 2 months ago now? It seems like a long time ago. We probably should have run this when we were talking to Scott, but our slow-mo stuff is kind of JV compared to his. We rented that slow-mo camera, the Sony FS700, 7000.
All right.
Which is a 4K camera, like 4K for reals, 4K camera.
Yeah.
But it also does up to 960 frames a second high-speed video.
Okay.
And it reduces some resolution there. But Joey, we should probably wait until Norm gets back. Yeah. That's a good idea.
Are you going to run some slow-mo footage?
This is a world premiere right here.
Oh, this has not been on the...
No, it's not been on the internet yet.
Okay.
We'll reward the early AM people.
All right, well, I'm going to go to the bathroom. When I come back, I'll
I think Norm's in there right now, so you should stay here until he comes back, so I'm not here all by myself.
All right. Oh, that's right. I'm not allowed to leave you alone.
I mean, you could leave me alone, but I wouldn't do that. I can't promise what'll happen. I'm going to... Do you want me to move over so you can...
So this is regular Black Blood of the Earth, but this is... So what's the difference between this and the other one?
It's just different kinds of coffee. So that's the Malabar. I have an Ethiopian over here.
All right, so I'm going to go to the restroom.
And I'm just sitting here. We're just talking. Norm, do you know what time 5 a.m. is?
Brick time.
It is time for mini brick.
That's why I was cleaning out my desk, cleaning off my desk.
But, hey, would you take this back before, or Gary, would you put that in the fridge?
Do I have one?
Thank you. Yeah, I put it on your desk.
Okay,
it's right there.
See it. This?
So, this is Black Blood of the Earth.
Joey from LA, how you feeling? You look about like I feel.
Ooh. This one...
It's Malabar. It's a...
Malabar.
It's a,
consumption. Keep it below 100 milliliters per day. Is highly recommended. Keep refrigerated. Please use all safe caffeine handling protocols.
So it means you wear gloves if you handle it.
All right. And this is 50 milliliters. Shot?
I'm waiting a little bit.
You're waiting a little bit. You're waiting a little bit. Are we recording nonstop?
We should not drink Death Wish at 2x because it is
that's a bad idea.
Double caffeine. What Joey's gonna run the slow mo clip. We're gonna roll the film.
What? We're gonna roll it?
Well, okay, let's give the people who are up with us in the darkest part of night a reward. That's what I say. We don't have to.
We can do it. Sure. I mean, that's kind of defeats the point of a live podcast. We do voiceover over it.
Well, that is a good point. We could just not do it. It's probably a bad idea to, you know, roll the... I mean, we definitely can talk over it.
I just want to know, technically, does it count as cheating for a 24-hour podcast if you have pre-taped footage that you're going to use instead of talking on the podcast for, you know, 6 minutes?
Is it 6 minutes?
It is six
minutes. Oh, that's too long. We can't do that. Norm, how you feeling?
I'm feeling fine.
You want to do another Marvel pack while we're here waiting for Gary to come
back? I can do another Marvel pack. I could also have a Black Blood of the Earth.
You could do whichever you want.
Let me see. So Blood of the Earth. Now, for people who don't know, this is just cold brewed coffee.
It's vacuum distilled.
What is vacuum distilled? Cold brewed, and
it's just super concentrated.
It's like the way they make whiskey.
No, not exactly. Whiskey is a little different. Whiskey, you just distill over heat.
Oh, it smells wonderful.
So you do this over low temperature so that you don't...
Are you both doing it?
I had a little sip. I like to savor my coffee. I'm not drinking it like a shot.
I could totally drink this like a shot.
That's a bad idea. Just pace yourself. You don't want to have a caffeine crash and spike period. Norm's going to open a marble pack. We decided not to do the video because it's 6 minutes long. I forgot that.
That's cheating.
Yeah, that's cheating. That's what it's I not thought. Live is the thing we realized. Mm. So
tastes great.
It's time for Mini Brick, though. And you're going to do live color commentary while Norm and I build stuff. Unfortunately, the tables aren't really set up. Although we could, you know, I could switch with you, Gary, and we could put the piles between us to mix them up. But I think probably at this point, judging by my mental state, like having to just build anything is going to be hard enough without having to mix the pieces with each other.
I don't think that you should do one big pile. I think you should each have your own pile.
Yeah, that's where I'm
let's
at
not,
as well.
Let's not overreach.
Because the thing is, in reality, we have to be done by 6:30 or 7, I think. 7 is our next guest.
Who's our next guest?
Bradley Shoemaker.
Oh, Brad Shoemaker at 7.
7 a.m. Okay.
So I think we can do that.
Oh, yeah. We have an hour and like it's not going to take us an hour.
50 minutes. It's a 400-piece kit.
Let me open a marble pack. But now that you have taken the box out...
Oh, you got another Silver Surfer.
What do you got there? Do you got another Silver Surfer?
I do. So maybe it's not as rare as I thought it was.
Hey, guys. Now, look. This is very special. We talked about what was the right Lego.
You need to get up on the mic. You're not in front of the mic.
We talked about what was the right kind of Lego to...
Yeah.
To have for the Return of Bricked.
Yeah.
Previously, you had two epically large... Star Wars sets, more than 3,000 pieces each. And that was a marathon.
Yeah.
We wanted something that was appropriate for a sprint, a quick build, something you could do in one session in under an hour.
Closer to the X-Wing versus TIE Fighter challenge.
The challenge, yeah. If you remember.
Yeah, close, more like the mini challenge that you did.
Now, how long did that challenge take?
Two episodes, 1 hour.
You'll be able to, but this is fewer pieces. We wanted something that was less than 500 pieces.
Yeah.
And we initially, for a Halloween theme, had looked at the Mad Scientist laboratory from the Lego Monster Fighters series, which is great. But then you guys had what I thought was an even better idea, to do the Minecraft.
Yeah, because we didn't want something that was a playset. I wanted something that was one cohesive unit.
Yeah, it's not a playset. It's a cool model, and of course, Minecraft is something that the tested
it's close to our
audience
hearts.
will appreciate.
Yeah. I mean, I'm a fan of Minecraft.
And this is a rare piece. I mean, I'm a Lego fan. I go to the Lego store a lot. I've never actually seen this in the stores. Well, it's sold out very quickly.
No, it's a Kuso.
It's a Kuso.
So there's no.
It's actually only sold at Lego.com.
Right.
And it is out of stock right now.
So this was a very specialty piece. In fact, didn't you have to go on eBay to get one of these?
Norm went...
I did go on eBay to get this one.
I bought mine when they were new. I pre-ordered. So
I'm very excited about this. The idea, I think... Now, just remind me, who won the last Bricked?
Norm. Right. Norman Chan
did. I did.
However, the controversy, which wasn't a controversy...
What was the controversy? Well, the controversy was that you habitually cheated, certainly.
I did not cheat.
I also, Stephen P. Lynn came by earlier this week and dropped off a ton of Pocky.
A ton of what?
Pocky. Pocky.
So you have some colon there.
What do you have there for us?
So
do you have man Pocky?
Talk to the microphone.
I got chocolate mint Pocky.
Ooh.
You've already opened that, it looks like.
There's one more in
I
here.
I might have some chocolate mint
And
Pocky.
There's something here that's special.
That doesn't sound good at all.
This is why I wanted to get rid of the cans.
No, that has to happen eventually. That
it's just happen. On your pants.
Yeah, it's
this
right,
one's
fine.
Called sweatpants. Colon.
C-O-L-L-O-N. Yeah.
It looks like a piece of colon.
It does.
It looks, you know what it looks like?
Colon.
It looks like a combo. Do you remember the combo snacks?
They still make them.
Yeah. The pizza flavored, cheese flavored combo snacks. Mm. It looks like that, but this is actually cheesecake flavored colon.
Wow. Okay.
I'm very interested
in
trying this.
Japanese also?
Yes. Absolutely.
So what we're going to do during, does the winner get the colon? Is that what happens?
I think we can all indulge in the colon. Oh,
what have you done?
Oh, you've broken
my
heart.
Goodness, you broke my heart.
Mm.
Why, good God? Gag. Why? Not the heart.
So, I mean, is there anything on the line here other than bragging rights? Or is there some kind of forfeit for the loser or what? How do you want to approach this?
I think bragging rights is sufficient. You can't
think?
Hear me right now because I'm not on the microphone.
I think honestly,
if we both stay awake, everybody wins.
That's the
goal here.
The loser has to get the black blood of the earth.
That's ridiculous. It's not a good idea. You gotta keep with this show must go on.
Ridiculous. That's ridiculous.
I think bragging rights is enough. I don't think anyone has to chop their pinky finger off or anything.
Mm. Well, if
if you want to, don't let me.
Right hand or left hand? Let's be real here.
We take some Advil first. Yakuza style.
Okay.
Fingers you don't really use.
Okay, so before we waste any more time prattling on, where's the auction at?
We have plenty of time, don't worry.
Because we don't actually have plenty of time. We have 2 hours before the next guest.
You're going to be fine.
It's and then we can take plenty of time. We can always take calls.
$220 is the current.
Unlike previous breaks, I will be here to provide color commentary.
Thank goodness.
And
keep it interesting, actually.
And lend you both moral support and let you know how I think you're doing.
So, Gary, I think your task in here is to be fair in that you have to engage both of us in conversation. So you can't just, ask each of us.
I don't
want to
unduly
questions.
Distract either one of you,
exactly.
More than the other.
You should do this kitchen stadium style as if you're commentating on the match and then ask occasional questions.
That's exactly what I'm going to do.
So you talk to the audience, but also engage us, but in a balanced way.
Also make sure that neither of us fall asleep.
Will has cleared off a space here so that people can see him build. Norm, right. I think you need to similarly clear a little space here so that people can see what you're up to.
I would put the Marvel cards
over. You can
off
put
to
some
side,
stuff
perhaps.
Over. Let's get some stuff over here. I'm going to, oh my God, look at all these wrappers. Did I really eat all this much garbage candy?
That's not good.
I guess I did. Let me clear away some space here.
I'll just put this all in
my Mr.
Space.
Lid.
Ah, there you go.
That's some good thinking.
Always thinking.
Not only is it good for storing food
also,
and stacking in the closet cupboard,
storing garbage.
You can also put your garbage there.
Yeah. Very smart.
I just want to get this going. I'm ready to do some building.
Wait, we're not ready yet.
I know. I'm waiting.
So antsy. I have not built Lego in a little while.
Since Gary had a kid, it turns out. Except for I built R2-D2 after my birthday, which was super fun. He's right there. He's a fantastic. If you haven't built, it's an expensive model, but it's a great, great model.
What is
the R2-D2?
Oh, it's
fantastic.
Right. Yeah,
it's brilliant.
I'm very excited about building that B-wing.
Yeah, yes. I haven't done that
yet. You still
either.
Owe me money.
I have money. Will owes me money, and Joey owes me money, and then combined, I have enough money to give you today.
Well, I don't have I don't have the money I owe you right now because I was doing it you style.
So this is the Minecraft micro world.
Just to remind people, it's 8 o'clock on the East Coast now, 8:20. So if you're just joining us and you want to donate, it's tester.com/donate. Go to the bottom of the chip in. Money goes straight to Child's Play. We're getting ready to build Lego.
Mini brick. What a
so
perfect
the
time
Minecraft
to pledge.
Set, 480 pieces. What's your time estimate on how long you think you would take to build that?
I looked at this. You look at the outside of the box, and I think it's a lot of like one by one pieces. It's a lot of small detail work. So
it's a lot of little. It actually reminds me a lot of the Lego architecture sets.
Yeah,
a lot of little flat
like
tiles,
falling water, and some of those.
There's a lot of detail
slow.
Work here.
So I think that this could go pretty long, which is why I'm anxious to start. I don't want to. I don't want to eat into Brad Shoemaker time.
All right. Well, here's what I'm going to do. I'm not going to impose any rules.
Not impose any.
I think that's best.
Well, you can't go over there and like fuck up all his pieces.
Okay. That's a rule.
To your own ship. I'm just saying, there's no. You're both
no
free.
Touching the other person's stuff.
Well, that's always a rule. Lego or not.
You learned that in elementary school.
You are free to approach this in any way you see fit.
So we don't have to follow the instructions as written in the book.
And should any disputes arise, I will be the final arbiter.
And you'll be judging the final
completed. You will abide by my decision.
You'll be judging the final works. Are you open to
bribery? What?
Are you open to bribery?
No, I will be fair and impartial.
And you're judging the final works based on the final image. There's only one set configuration that is the correct
one. I will also be the judge of when you are finished.
So what is the correct configuration? What will you be judging it on?
It looks like the correct configuration is actually the front of box configuration.
Okay. We are using the front of box picture.
Well, I presumably you'll also be going by the instruction manual, which is in the box.
I hope so.
Now, we do have to take a quick pause at 6 o'clock exactly to do the changeover on the video and the audio.
So you'll be
the arbiter of that. Joey will come in our ears and tell us.
Yes, and you'll be hands-off. And you will be hands-off.
And
that
I have
period.
To do my computer stuff. Norm, you have to police Norm during that time.
Don't worry.
Can't be trusted.
I can watch both of you.
Okay.
So
get a shake on this chin?
I don't want to touch you. Are we... Are we peeling the tape off here? Because I might have a problem. I don't have fingernails right now.
We're peeling the tape off.
Is peeling the tape off
Wait,
part of,
no, that's
part
do of not, the competition? You do not start without my
Do you have
mine?
This box is dinged up.
This is where he starts making excuses for himself. It's a cube. I like the packaging.
Do we need to trade this before?
Does yours have dust on top? Mine's been under the bed for a few months.
Just set it down.
No dust.
Okay, put it down on the table.
Set it down on the table.
How far away from our hands? Hands behind our back?
No, you
know, behind our heads? You guys are taking this to extremes.
By all means. Also, now is a great time to pledge.
Yeah, if you want to bet on a winner,
please,
you know,
accompanying
at this moment,
donation.
The value of this podcast should be more evident than ever. And so you should really go to tested.com/donate and use the little chip in widget to donate some money.
We're not
going to
start until we get
$1,000
more.
I'm having a little more
blood. We're just
going
to sit here like
this. Let's see where we are. Let's see where we're at now. So we've got a baseline. We're at $9,301 right now. Let's see where we are by the end of this little escapade. Norm taking a last little slug of Black Butter of the Earth, hoping for a little jolt.
Thanks for bringing me some water when you brought the Black Blood of the Earth, by the way.
You didn't ask for that.
I thought it was understood.
So it's currently 5:23 a.m.
My arms are getting really tired.
You may start. I love it. I love the speed.
I fucked up the box. I'm so sad.
Norm is just tearing the shit out of the box. He's got a scorched earth approach here.
Norm loves to win.
Now, I'm going to be, right off the bat, I'm going to be very interested to see what your strategy is. If you're going to sort, if you feel like it's going to serve you better to sort pieces.
Or the bags aren't numbered.
Or if you're just going to throw everything. Norm is choosing to look at instructions right away, which may be a smart move. Will, however, is just randomly looking at bags, hoping to figure out what's what. And I noticed there's a brick separator in there. That's pretty good.
They put a brick separator? Oh, that is nice.
Well, you know why? Because there's probably a lot of flat tile pieces. They may feel like you may need one if you make a mistake. So, Norm, let me ask you right away, what's going to be your early strategy here? Are you thinking about sorting or...?
Yeah, loose sorting.
Okay. So, keeping bags separate?
Yes. Although the bags are not numbered.
Right. So, you don't necessarily know where you should start. Sometimes in the bigger sets, the bags aren't numbered, so you know to build bag one first.
I mean, one of the nice things about this set is it's a relatively small footprint, so we shouldn't have to have too much trouble making space, which was one of the problems
with
the Death
Star. But a lot of small pieces.
There are a lot of small pieces in here.
And, well, I see you're already building your little construction yard. You're going for the regimented approach?
I'm doing light sorting as well. I think that's the right approach for 480 pieces in a limited period of time.
Okay, because one thing that we have learned in our adult careers as Lego builders is that just throwing all the pieces into a pile...
That was your doom.
...is utter folly.
Yeah, it's a mistake
every
time.
You will end up spending way more time that way. than if you spend a little bit of time at the beginning just to sort your pieces.
Well, sometimes you think that, and then Norm does the last bag without sorting, and it turns out to go really fast because, you know, it was an easy bag. I'm not saying that's what happened before. I'm just saying it's a possibility.
I think I like this set. I like the colors, the green, the different shades of green, and
it's a. I quite like the set from the beginning. When it was a Kuso set, I pre-ordered because I thought it was
Kuso.
Sorry, I thought it was. I thought it looked pretty awesome. Happy to give him my $40 or whatever it happened to be. $50. How much was
it? So I have put my first piece down.
Interesting. Norm has already affixed his first piece as well.
I'm doing fine
your job
with that.
For you.
I'm doing some sorting here.
Gary. I think Will is thinking that a greater investment in sorting will pay off later in the game.
I'm hoping that that's the case, but I don't know. I haven't looked at the instructions for this. I have no idea.
I'm feeling that black blood.
See, I think that's probably a strong advantage on my side as well.
In what way are you feeling the black blood? Are you feeling kind of jacked?
Some bowel rumbles? Is that what's happening?
Are you kind of jazzed? Are you seeing everything in four dimensions?
I think I'm feeling the adrenaline, actually, mostly.
My worry is that your hands might start shaking.
That would be real bad.
That's not what you need.
A small detail piece like this.
Will still sorting. Right now, by my account here, Norm has already affixed maybe 9 or 10 pieces together. Will is still in construction yard mode. So I'm hoping
unwrapped everything.
I'm hoping for your sake that this strategy is going to save
you
more time
down
the road.
I'm going to start with book one. Gary.
Oh, there's two instruction books?
Two instruction books. It's a controversial move, I know.
I think starting with book one is probably the prudent move.
So the way this kit goes together, it's four quadrants, I believe, just from looking at the instructions and the outside of the box. And I think that maybe it doesn't matter whether you do side one or side two first. It's interesting, though. It looks like we're affixing lava and water to the base of this kit right now, though. So, a little surprised by that, I'll be perfectly honest.
See Joey doing some good ESPN-style camera work here, cutting back and forth.
Joey...
Seeing a little bit of the detail work.
Joey did a little bit of work on the original run of Bricked, way back in 2012.
That was a pretty epic series.
It was pretty something. It was a powerful source of dumb.
Well, it certainly got, you know, people riled up because there were many allegations of impropriety.
It was every bit as real as wrestling, Gary.
Unsportsmanlike conduct.
And a spectacular finish.
It was a pretty good
finish. Very spectacular.
I think we can all agree upon that.
And, you know, it was interesting because the narrative was as dramatic as you would want it to be. For a long time, it seemed like Norm was really very much behind the eight ball, and then the picture started to change, and suddenly you, Will, were... it wasn't even close in the end, was it? Let's be honest.
We knew from the beginning that I was in a hole.
It did go to the last episode.
Well, that was better than we thought it was going
to
go.
To be fair, you know, it was never really an even playing field because you were building two different models. So there was no way to really know who had the easier... It wasn't equitable. This is actually the first time you guys have both built the exact same model.
This is the first time we faced off in a fair competition.
This is
a fair competition,
Gary. A level playing field. You both got the exact same set. This may end up being a closer arbiter of who actually is the Lego builder.
It's what all the people want to know.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like the first Bricked, as entertaining as it was, really really asked more questions than it answered, and left a lot of unanswered questions, a lot of controversy and bad blood, which has been roiling ever since. Maybe this is what it'll take.
I got the Jimmy legs. I got the Jimmy legs.
The black blood's already doing its thing. There's just something else about the sight of a dude in like black tie and cufflinks building Lego that is just kind of surreal. It is kind of like cut-rate James Bond.
You know, I like to elevate speed Lego building game. It's one of the things I bring to the sport.
It's like an infantile James Bond villain has challenged you not to, you know, Baccarat or something for your life, but Lego building.
I feel like this is something that could be on ESPN4. If there were an ESPN4.
It could be on the Ocho.
No, the Ocho, it's not good enough for the Ocho, I don't think. How am I? Where's the status? Where are we at in relation to each other, Gary? This is what the people want to know.
It's hard to say. I'm looking. I guess
I'm on number step 7.
I guess right now I would say that Norm has more built. But again, Will has invested more of his early time in sorting, and that may end up giving him a speed boost later. But I gotta say, Norm really seems like he's building in super fast motion right now.
Maybe I should have had more of the black blood.
That, I mean, the black blood seems to have kind of propelled him into like fast forward mode or something.
I don't know if the black blood counts as doping.
What is the deal with the gold brick? Is that indicative of like the gold that you mine in Minecraft?
I believe
something?
It is. Okay. Or it could be copper alternately. This is a little bit of a tricky build. There's some weird perspective stuff going on here. And I need one more 3x1. Or 3x2, rather.
Yeah, I mean, this is really old school Lego because there's very, very few, if any, I think, custom pieces, right? These are all just classic Lego bricks.
I think the custom work is in the colors here, actually. Because the gold color is unusual, I believe.
Well, certainly, I mean, the colors are rare for Lego, and that's what makes this so interesting. But there aren't any, like, custom-shaped pieces. These are all just pretty standard Lego tiles that you'd see in any typical set.
That is
I think the mistake for either of us is if any pieces fall to the floor. Because I don't think either of us are in
position. Oh, my God. If one of your pieces goes flying, you're pretty much screwed. So I would...
be very careful.
Yes, recommend that you be very, very careful. And again, that may be why Norm's black blood could end up coming to bite him in the ass later. With his shaky hands and pieces kind of slipping out of his feverish grip.
We don't want any fever dreams here, Gary.
But so far, both of you seem to be... I mean, it's hard to eyeball it from here, but I think Norm's a little bit ahead.
But
there's not a whole lot in it right now.
What is Will? What stage is he at right now?
I'm having a lot of fun, Norm. I'm just here for the kids. Playing the game one day at a time. Trying to do the best I can. Not embarrass my family or my wife.
It's too late for that.
Unborn child. Just doing the best we can. I'm on to page 8, step 1 again. I built the
first... Right, and that's where Norm is as well. And
so you're saying I've closed the gap.
You just started on that brown base plate, and Norm's already got quite a few pieces on that base plate. So again, I still think he's maintaining a slight edge. He is the Obama to your Romney in Lego
Norm
polling.
You know, one of the things we found about Norm is that he, the moment things start to go a little sideways, he kind of goes to pieces, has a tendency to do that. I'm not saying that that's something that will happen today, but given the high stress conditions of this competition, it's not out of the question. I'm wondering if a little pre-sorting is not a good idea at this point.
I thought you did
pre-sorting. No. Sort the stacks, sort the sections, then do some building, then sort the sections. Sort the stacks some more. This looks like a tree surface, which is kind of interesting.
Does this all end up as one block, or are there different
pieces? I think there are different configurations for it, but it ends up as 4 individual blocks.
Okay.
If anything, my mistakes are in sorting right now. I'm doing a bad job of pulling out pieces in bunches.
I mean, again, when you've got a lot of uniform pieces like this, sorting is often useful.
Well, and they're all tiny, which doesn't help.
Yeah, really tiny little flat tiles. Oh, God. This is what I'm worried about.
This is why. Hey, you're impartial. Why are you worried?
Well, because I worry that if one of you has a tragic mistake here, then it won't be close and it won't be exciting. I'm mostly concerned about this being a close race. I'm not favoring any one candidate, although I would prefer that Norm win.
Good to know.
But I'm completely powerless here as a judge. I think that, you know, I'm really just here as an observer. And I'll
educate fairly as long as it's
I'll
not
I'll arbitrate
even.
In the case of any, should any dispute arise. But this seems like seems to be fairly equitable so far. And you guys are doing a good job of policing yourselves.
It's a very pretty build.
It is an attractive.
I like the colors.
I almost feel bad that I'm rushing through it, actually. I kind of want to savor this.
Nothing says that you have to rush through it.
Yeah, take your
very
time.
Very clever, Chan.
Save every brick. You could always disassemble it and rebuild it again.
It's not the same as the first time.
That's true. You only get to build it for the first time once. But speed building is kind of fun. No, does this take... I mean, do you feel like your history in speed building PC competitions in any way helps you here? Or is it completely
Will has
discipline?
A history in...
What was your best finish in that speed building PC competition, Norm? Just out of curiosity. Like just like 6th or something? 16th? 12th?
No,
14th. What is this, some kind of half-assed mind game you're playing right now?
No. What was my best finish? Do you recall?
Technicality. First place on technicality.
And what was the second best finish? Second place, I think, if I recall correctly?
I do not recall.
You might not have been there.
How did
year.
You win on a technicality?
The guy in front of me didn't build his PC correctly, so therefore the next person in line wins.
And what exactly was the problem with his build?
He didn't plug some shit in, as I recall. Plug in an optical
and
drive.
And did you point that out, or did...
The judges pointed out. Okay. I was building my own PC while they were judging him.
So he actually beat you, but was ruled void, and so you by default won?
I didn't win by default. I won because I had the next fastest time. I was the first person to complete the build successfully.
It is the greatest two words in the greatest word in English language.
Default, that's right.
That's what Homer Simpson says, at least.
So, looking at you guys right now, so I actually think Will might be catching up a little bit. It's starting to look very hard from where I'm sitting to see much difference in the progress of your two builds. It appears to be pretty close.
When you're picking up all these
I think Norm has maybe a razor-thin edge, but there's not much in it at all.
When you're picking up all these little super tiny pieces, I would think a little caffeine would be a real impediment to success.
I agree.
Oh, and he's going back.
The caffeine may have been... Oh, brick separator is out. That's not a good sign.
I wonder what people who have never watched this before are thinking right now.
I think they're probably thinking it's the greatest content they've ever seen on the internet.
It's really too bad we don't have a high-speed camera to give them the complete experience.
If you never saw the original bricks, I mean, they're all archived. It's worth going back and watching them.
One of my good friends
learned
a
lot about human nature.
8-year-old watched that, which I think is gross negligence on the part of a parent, but we're still friends. Maybe 10-year-old, I guess.
So you've been building right now for a little under 15 minutes.
How are we doing on... we're good on time, right?
It's 5:37 a.m. I gotta say, this is... now that I've actually got something to kind of really keep me occupied...
This was genius, right?
I'm starting to feel... This could have been... This could be just the boost we needed.
To get us through the...
To get us into that second wind phase.
Well, you know what they say.
I don't know, what do they
say? It's always darkest just before dawn.
Oh, I see. More of that. Okay.
Platitudes. Oh, I'm building a tree into the tree building portion of the contest.
Yep. Your builds do look very, very similar,
you know,
right?
I realize I made a mistake too.
Aha.
Luckily mine is easily rectified.
Norm, are you still feeling now? Are you wishing that you hadn't had the coffee? Is it more of a detriment than a help at this point?
No.
Do you feel like it's making any difference either way?
Coffee, I think, definitely helped.
It did help.
It did help. I might have had too much.
Even though you had the Jimmy legs,
The Jimmy legs are a result of me putting the instruction manual on my lap.
Okay.
Oh, you think it's moving too much.
Norm has completed his tree.
Ooh, he's definitely ahead of me at this point, then. Hopefully my sorting's going to pay off. I may have made the same fatal error that I made last time.
And what is that?
I sorted too much. I sorted when he was building and gave him the opportunity to sneak ahead in the last hours of the contest.
Yeah, I mean, I remember you really did have a remarkably regimented... I mean, things weren't just sorted. I mean, they were really stacked in...
I'm going to go ahead and tell you, I don't fuck around.
It almost like OCD. It was almost OCD levels of sorting.
I resemble that.
It was like a little miniature construction yard. It was pretty impressive.
Any comments from the peanut gallery?
I can check the chat real quick. We'll see what people are saying.
I'm afraid that that this is going to kill us in the end because I'm expending a lot of mental energy.
I think that a little mental energy spent right now is probably not a bad thing. I think once the sun comes up, we go outside, stand in the conference room for a moment and see that there is still life outside, that today has turned into tomorrow. I think that's going to be a good thing for all involved.
It's going to be one of those things when we finally walk out of here and emerge blinking into the daylight, because it'll still be daylight when we finally get out of
so
here.
So does this just rest on top? That seems reckless.
I don't think it rests on top. It seems
it's a lid.
It fits on top.
Oh, so Norm's already onto
Norm at this point actually is starting to pull away.
Well, he is younger and smarter than me.
Yes. I don't think anybody would disagree. Yeah, he's something happened there where Norm has I don't know if you sped up or you slowed down or what, but I'd say there's a 2 or 3 point gap between the two of you at this point.
What do the exit polls say, Gary?
The exit polls are strongly pro-Norm.
I don't like that. I think I should talk less and go faster.
Let's see.
I'm wasting too much time entertaining people for the kids.
And let's not forget that this is not about the winning.
Yeah, it is. It's about the
taking part, the spirit of athletic competition, and for charity. That's what when you have these charity competitions, you really just got to look at it in that spirit. It's not like whoever wins this is gonna have it.
I'm going to Disneyland.
Held over them immensely.
Yeah, not
forever.
For a year or two at least.
That's not the sort of thing that the winner of this contest would do to the loser. I'm sure you're both bigger than that.
Is that a fat joke? Oh, that goes this way.
No.
Wait, that goes this way. So the problem with this kit is going to be verification of successful completion, because there are a lot of little fiddly bits here.
Yeah, it seems like the kind of set where it would be easy to cut corners. But again, if there are any pieces left over, we're gonna know about it.
Here's the
easy way. I will examine the finished thing.
An easy way to judge that is to compare our builds.
That's true. You can Gary can disassemble.
I suspect that if and when Norm finishes first, we'll be demanding a thorough inspection of his build.
Well, I mean, you'll have time
to make sure that it's valid.
I mean, to compare my build and Will's build, and then. If there is a difference, use that difference as the basis.
How would you rate the difficulty level of this set so far?
It's not too bad.
I think it's pretty difficult.
It seems fairly straightforward.
Boy, I'm getting into some fast places now. Things are going real well. There's definitely slow and fast bits. I will say that. I like that we're building little caves in each of these quadrants. I think that's really cool.
Yeah, and is there a gold piece at the center of each one?
Not necessarily a gold piece, but there's a waterfall in this last one that I just
finished. Oh, that's cool.
So that's pretty cool. Not at all what I was expecting.
Seems like it's going to be the size of it. It's going to be a pretty small model by the time it's all done, right? This is not like a big thing.
No, I don't think it's large. I'm moving on to my next base.
Okay.
I don't know where Norm is at in relation to that, because our commentary
is... Yeah, Norm is... I think you may have closed the gap ever so slightly, Will, but Norm is still... I'd say at this point, Norm has got a... let me see... I'd say Norm has got like a 7 or 8 piece lead, which is actually not that much.
Piece or step?
Piece. If it was steps, there'd be no contest.
Yeah, I'd be feeling real.
No, like literally bricks ahead. He's maybe 6 or 7 bricks ahead of you.
I'm just going to say I'm glad I untied the tie before we started this.
You look like the most interesting man in the world doing Lego. You just need like a bottle of Dos Equis there or something.
That seems about right. Are you saying I'm not normally naturally interesting?
I would never say anything.
Plead the fifth. It's fine. And always, as always, the problem here is the diabolical lack of difference between dark gray and light gray.
Well, now, this one, there's dark green and light green.
That is also true.
The problem is not the difference between dark gray and light gray. It's that black pieces in the Lego manual often show up as dark gray. And you can drive yourself crazy looking for a dark gray piece without realizing you're actually looking for a black piece.
This also is true.
So let me see. It's kind of harder to see Will's build, but I'm placing Norm
a bunch of red pieces
Norm
right now.
Yeah, well,
I assume they're lava.
Norm is he's maintaining his very thin lead.
If you're just adding false drama, I'm going to know on the replay, Gary.
No. I'm not trying to create like a narrative for the sake of tension here. It is, you know, if it wasn't close, and people would be able to see it for themselves.
That's probably true.
Seeing a little bit of the main structures with the tree on top that you two have built, Will's one doesn't look quite the same as Norm's. And I'm wondering if that's because one of you guys has incorrectly built, or if I'm just looking at it wrong.
It may be rotated. It does look different on all four sides.
Okay.
So these are definitely not symmetrical. And it looks like they go together in really interesting ways.
How much did this set sell for? Is it like $50 or something?
I think it was $50.
Yeah, it sounded like they all sold out. I mean, I'm sure there's a lot of Minecraft fanatics out there that scooped all these up right away.
It was pretty popular on the Kuso site, as I recall. Oh man, I'm on to 8 1x1x dark gray divots. It's
those That's little fiddly 1x1 pieces are just killer.
Worst.
Yeah. If you do the architecture sets, you spend a lot of time dealing with those. And with those little flat tiles, those little flat 2x1 tiles.
Oh, you know what? This is the place where my earlier mistake totally comes back to save my ass.
Shit. Oh. Was that the first...
What happened?
I just dropped a piece, but it's cool. I got it back.
You recovered it? Okay. Because that really could be disastrous.
That could be
that one rogue piece that just kind of like bounces away and didn't know where it went.
Oh, holy shit. This is a nightmarish mess of pieces here.
I am going to take this opportunity to invite the chat to ask questions. So if you're watching this and you're in the chat and you have a question, by all means... put it out there, and if I see anything interesting, I will put it to Will and Norm,
or answer it yourself,
or indeed, if it's a question for me, maybe I'll answer it. We'll see.
Let's get crazy here. I accidentally skipped ahead a couple of steps, but it's all. Don't worry, everything's fine.
Whoa, is that legal?
Yeah, we decided no order is disallowed.
Yeah, you're free to build this in any way you see fit. It's all about just getting to the finish line,
as long as it's the right way.
Yeah, it has to be following the law of the land.
How far is the Earth from the Sun? The answer is 93 million miles.
Nice job, Gary.
That's a good question.
That's a good pull.
What Lego set would you like to see put out by Lego?
I want that Curiosity Rover.
Do you have a fantasy Lego? Curiosity Rover would be great. I think that's a great. Very good idea. I like that idea a lot. Norm, do you have a fantasy Lego set that you'd like to see?
Curiosity would be awesome.
Curiosity would be. I think we can all agree on the Curiosity Rover.
I got a little confused there.
Somebody wants to know when Jeff Gerstmann's showing up, and the answer is at 8 a.m. So,
or possibly a little earlier.
Oh, really? Okay. Yeah, he's scheduled to arrive on the schedule for about 2 hours from now.
He's coming, I think he might even be coming straight from an airport. I'm not entirely certain. I don't know if I can talk about that. We're not talking about that at this time. But yeah, Jeff's going to be here. Jeff was a stalwart in the early hours of last year's show.
Kind of helped us finish it off.
And brought it all the way home, yeah. He was. I would even go so far as to say an honorary fourth chair.
Someone in chat wants to know what games Norm has been playing.
Not too many. I can't even think off the top of my head right now.
All right.
Where are these pieces going? I'm very confused.
Will, one of our listeners, watchers, whatever, wants to know if Tested is ever coming back to Roku.
That, unfortunately, is not my decision. We have to do some technical stuff in order to make that happen.
And because we're hosting videos on YouTube now, it makes it a little bit more difficult. Boy, the neat thing about this is they actually made the veins through the... we would like to bring it back to Roku is the short answer to the question. I don't know how viable that is, given the kind of resources we have for development and stuff right now. I wish I had a better answer.
Here's a good question. Somebody wants to... This is for both of you. One of the guys in the chat wants to know... what is the magazine situation like on Android tablets? If you buy an Android tablet, are you going to be able to get read a lot of like New Yorker and Time and get magazine subscriptions on the Android the way you can on iOS?
There's a fair amount of stuff in the Google Play Store, and you can actually browse all of that from the web. So you can look and see yourself like to see specifically which magazines you want. I don't read a lot of magazines on tablets. It's like it is I. Profoundly dislike, like while I'm completely down with books, I subscribed to the digital edition of Wired and upgraded, which I love reading, and I upgraded it immediately to a paper version because I couldn't cope with the tablet, even on the iPad, which is, you know, quite good as far as the magazine reading.
Yeah, I tried the digital version of Wired on the iPad on a plane ride, and I ended up the next trip bringing the actual magazine.
Yeah, it's not that it's bad. I like the physical aspect of it, and for me, one of my key reading times is in that 20 minutes while you're waiting for the plane to get to 10,000 feet. So it was a little bit of a bummer that I couldn't read magazines then.
Norm, do you regret not going to PAX Prime this year?
No, I've been traveling a lot. I do regret though that weekend not going to Dragon Con.
Dragon Con and PAX are the same weekend.
If I was going to travel that weekend, I would have gone to Dragon Con.
I feel like I missed something, but I don't see what it is.
I'm trying to see where you two guys checking in right now on the status of your builds. And
Norm's probably ahead. I hit a little bit of
Will
a snag
appears
here.
To be somewhat dumbfounded.
I'm better now. I figured it out.
Norm is really gunning it.
Where the hell's my book two?
Oh, so there's a milestone. Norm has now moved on to instruction book two. How many pages do you have left in your book, Will?
One, I think.
Okay,
maybe two.
So you're nearly finished, but that's definitely a significant milestone.
Yes, Gary, thanks for bringing that up.
It's my job. I'm the commentator. It's my job to provide context. And the context is Norm looks like he's winning right now. But a long way to go. I'm still a lot of unbuilt pieces. A lot of things can happen.
You know, the thing we found doing Lego builds is that frequently, once you start winning, it's hard to catch back up.
Someone asked if Tested's Minecraft server is still a thing.
I think it's still running. Still operational? Yeah. One of our users, we met him when we were in Portland, runs it. And I think they actually made the thread so long that it broke the forums and had to make a new thread. So, as far as I know, the Minecraft server is still going strong. There are a series of rules about it, and there's a forum thread that explains exactly what you need to know.
Is that something that somebody needs to kind of maintain and administrate, or is it pretty much just sits on a server and is self-sufficient?
It needs a little bit of love, just like a lot of things in the world.
If Norm wins, what will he do to advance the rights of women?
It's a good question. You know, I'm very interested to hear this.
I take them all out of binders.
As I'm moving on to book two.
Will is finally on book two.
Finally, it's been like 3 minutes. You put him in a trapper keeper. That's much worse.
3 minutes is a lifetime.
Only in name only.
3 minutes in Lego is like a week in politics. It's a long time.
You gotta check with Nate Silver with the Lego calculus.
That's right. What is the now cast on Lego? Certainly, if you were to stop right now, Norm, I think would have to be declared.
We're not stopping right now. I would be stopped right now.
I'm saying, were you to? Oh, more pieces dropped.
Dropped another piece, and here's a piece over here. This one might be one of Norm's, but it's on my side, so if it went over there. Oh, this is crazy. The head on this guy is awesome. On Steve.
Oh, you're making a little guy?
Making a little Steve. I have Steve and a creeper now.
Is Steve actually the name of the character
Steve
in Minecraft?
Steve is the guy's name, yeah.
Oh, okay.
He's right here.
Make sure you got the heads right.
Of course I got the heads right. What do I look like?
Oh, yeah, here he is. Look, here's Steve.
Steve has two heads.
Yeah, they go in a specific orientation. This is the kind of attention to detail that I was worried that Norm wasn't going to bring.
I actually have two Steve mouths.
You have two Steve mouths?
Yes.
Oh, I might have two Steve mouths, too.
I don't know what the deal is with that.
I have two Steve eyes. I do have two Steve mouths. Maybe you can make two Steves. That would be awesome.
I don't think we have the pieces for that.
Brad, and I'm presuming that's Brad Shoemaker, is asking us if we need anything.
If he wanted to bring pastries per his earlier threat, that would be totally cool. All
right, so I would.
But otherwise, just his smiling personality. How are we doing on time? What are we?
You know what I could really kill, but it's not going to be available for a while yet. Oh, maybe it is. Is an Egg McMuffin.
Hmm. I don't think I would send anybody to the McDonald's in our neighborhood right now because it's not real good. It's not a great neighborhood.
No, I wouldn't
want to. 5 o'clock in the morning is not a good time to go to find.
Even though that McDonald's across the street is right across the street from, like, the you know, the courthouse and a lot of police facilities, it doesn't necessarily mean it's a safe area.
No.
In fact, it can be a bit
probably
scary.
That means it's you know, and the plus side, if you ever need a bail bondsman, it's exactly where you go.
A lot of bail bonds outfits.
Yes, we have that right here. Honestly, right now, I could just use a little bit of that. Wait, hold on. When Brad was the shoebreaker, did he win or lose?
He lost.
Oh, I don't need the shoebreaker magic then. So we should probably think in a moment. About right, taking a quick break to do station ID and changeover.
Okay. Are you coming stuff. Up on one of those segment
it's,
breaks?
It's been 2 hours since the last one.
Okay. Well, do you want to take that break now or?
Whoa, Gary, you decide. You are
well, a
decisive.
Is it 6 o'clock yet?
It is 5:57. You want to do it right at 6?
You should do let Joey decide if you're worried about
okay.
it.
Okay.
I hope.
Well,
Joey's
I have
awake.
To keep an eye on you. I can't hear what Joey says. I can hear him talking next door, but I can't hear what
I
he's saying.
I think they're talking to Joey. Lieutenant Squiggs is in here. He kindly offered to come help us with this lunacy, which I thought was very nice. He's also one of our great mods on Tested, and is local in San Francisco these days.
Norm is still building at a very brisk and steady pace.
That's good. So am I. Yeah, hands up.
Okay, so here we go. So now hands off. We're gonna take a little break here to switch reels or whatever it is we do.
Yeah, we'll be back with more of OCTOBERKAST in just a minute. Stream exclusive content starts now. Oh, you're like two layers higher than me.
So let's
Can I drink water?
What?
Can I drink water?
Yeah, of course.
I don't have any water.